Hello and welcome to a new episode of the Game Informer Show. I'm your host, Ben Hanson, joined by Matthew Kato.
Hello.
Honor to have you, man. And then we got Andrew Reiner here.
Hello, hello.
You were just here last week, but it's nice to have you back.
Yeah.
And then we have, all right, don't blow it, Suriel.
Yeah.
All right, this is a new Game Informer hire. They're coming in fast and furious. We're just going to keep ballooning and eventually become Ubisoft Montreal here, I think.
Yeah, he doesn't have a last name.
What is your last name?
Vasquez.
Vasquez. I didn't want to blow it.
The U is silent.
And what's with the first name?
I don't know.
What's with that question?
It's like my mom told me it was like the name of an angel or something in Israeli lore or something. But funny because we're Catholic.
That's very confusing. So how many people just say Suriel?
A lot.
Is it offensive when you say Suriel?
No, I'm used to it at this point. Like I've had so many nicknames and like throughout my life that it's not a big deal.
Okay, so Suriel, people are just going to add some variation of that and you're okay with it all.
Yeah.
All right, so let's get your type down. Let's try and figure out what mold you fit into in the Game Informer office.
All right,
I've got the impression you're a fighting game guy.
Yeah,
is that number one?
That's up there. I haven't like ranked my interests.
Well, that's what this podcast is for, sir.
Okay, but yeah, they're probably I think the genre that distinguishes me most. I'm not like I haven't. Like played every game out there, right, or whatever, but I have, it's kind of been like the one genre I've stuck with the longest, like throughout most of my life.
But then in general you're kind of like an esports guy, one of those.
Yeah,
guys.
Like that was more recent. Like the honest truth is like I never really cared for multiplayer or anything until I started playing Dota.
Really?
Yeah,
the first Dota.
No, Dota 2, sorry.
Oh, okay.
That was like in 2012 that I started playing the beta for that game.
And you blasted through that and you learned to love it.
Yeah, I'm almost at 3,000 hours at this point.
Have you ever, does Dota 2, I know League of Legends has like that novelty mode where you can go one-on-one, right?
Yeah.
Does Dota 2 have any variant of that?
Yeah, Dota has like a one-on-one mode, yeah.
Will you be willing to go against Dan Tack in Dota 2?
Maybe.
Oh.
Hang on, let me write this down.
Write it, so
here's,
write it.
Here's the thing is that like the way that game works, there are different roles, and I've not played a lot of the mid role, which is the one that you would play one-on-one.
But after 3,000 hours, you've played enough of the mid-roll.
Yeah, you can just close your eyes
Dan
and win.
Tech, you can mop the floor with that guy. He doesn't know anything.
Something tells me you want Dan to lose.
It might be fun to see Dan lose. Wipe that smile off his face. Cool. Well, welcome aboard, man.
Thank you.
Here's what I know about you. This is the defining moment for... Okay. I was out last week, and so this is like my first week in the office with you,
right,
being around and whatnot. The defining moment is there was an article going up, and Kyle Hilliard, who sits next to you, said... Suriel, in this article, you're described as a fighting game expert. Are you cool with that? And immediately you're like, yep. That was a bold move. But you consider yourself
an
expert.
Well, we talked about it before, but I was like, I mentioned in the video that it's like, all right, I know a lot about these games, but like that doesn't mean I'm like, you know, competitive in them at all.
Okay.
Like I'm not good at them.
You're informed about
them. Yeah.
So what is the best fighting game ever made?
Capcom versus SNK2.
Why?
Because a lot of it is nostalgia. It was like totally a game I played in arcades. And then it was also like the first game that I watched competitive matches of.
Ooh.
So like I almost failed like a very basic computer management class because all I did was watch, you know, people like Ricky Ortiz and Combo Fiend play against each other for hours. And I got a B. I ended up getting a B in a class that I should have like gotten an A on. But I just did not study for any of the tests and just watched videos of that game like constantly. And then also had like a bunch of characters from games I knew. I had like Terry Bogard against, you know, Ryu.
That's
Street Fighter, so.
Yeah. I've recently really gotten into Darkstalkers. Somehow at age 29, I stumbled across the game Darkstalkers and have fallen in love with it. Where do you stand on Darkstalkers?
I think it's like more quirky than like most of the other fighting games. But
yeah,
which is funny because like I think Killer Instinct took some inspiration from it.
Because
like in the way the health works in those rounds is that like you kill their first health bar, but in the second round you still have whatever is left of your first health bar when you win, and they do that in Killer Instinct as well.
Do you think, because Iron Galaxy, who's making Killer Instinct season 2 and season 3 now, they made the remastered version of Darkstalkers.
Maybe that's two,
but it would have been Double Helix before that.
Yeah,
so maybe it was
that might be a question to ask someone.
Someone. I'll send it out of the void. But welcome aboard, sir.
Yeah.
Glad we can introduce you on this podcast because we got a lot to cover on this show. First of all, the tail end of the show, we're going to cover Deus Ex Human Revolution, the third part, the final installment of our game club. And it is a good chat, my favorite chat of the Deus Ex bunch. But please send feedback on what you want from the future of Game Club, like formatting or what games in particular. It's always fun to read those. Send stuff into podcast@gameinformer.com. We'll talk all about it. But for sure, stay tuned if you want to hear us ramble on about Deus Ex. But for this show, we're going to talk about No Man's Sky.
Yes!
We live in a post-No Man's Sky world now.
Yeah, I was trying to think of like, okay, there was so much anticipation. What's next? And it's just like this void right now. It's like,
Well, I heard you don't need any other game, that you can just play this one the rest of your life because it's infinite. We're also going to talk about Abzu with Matthew Kato, relaxation expert, the old meditator himself. Then we're going to talk about QuakeCon because you heard that, Reiner. There's a lot of cool stuff there. And then some other games here and there. Metroid II's cool remake, which is getting yanked off the internet faster than you can talk about.
It's been yanked.
Oh, God. But we got it pre-yanked. We can talk a little bit about that weird fan project. And then other stuff here and there. But to kick it off, No Man's Sky. Whew. All right. Where's everybody at? Kato, you've been playing a little bit of it?
Yeah. Yeah, I've been playing a little bit of it. I have a second ship. I've docked at a base. And, you know, I've got, you know, four or five planets or so under my belt and stuff. So, you know, it's a resource loop. And you know, my big question is, when is the fun of that, or when's that going to sort of wonderment going to run off? Because, you know, that's what it is. You're just constantly going after those resources, which is fine. But, you know, like everybody, you're just sort of wondering what the next sort of beat is, what the next loop is, and, you know, whatnot. So,
but is it like Abzu where you can just, hey, relax and meditate for a while, walk around this planet? Is that the incentive at all?
I think so. I mean, I think I have a little bit of that. I try to like stop and smell the roses, you know, and certainly, you know, investigate different things. So I wouldn't say I'm like in like the hardcore sort of grind, you know, mentality yet. I like to relax a little bit in there.
It's kind of fun. This happened with like Destiny, and every once in a while where a game comes out and, you know, reviewers don't have early copies. And so I feel like we're in this no man's ground about like no one really knows the verdict on No Man's Sky yet.
Yeah.
No real reviews have been put up. It's just too early. And so I think everyone in the world, after this gigantic game with so much hype is out, everyone's just looking at each other being like, is this good? Where were you at? Reiner, you've played a fair amount of it. Is it good?
Yeah, I would say it is a, you know, here's the weird thing. Let me back up a little. Two nights ago, I went on into this new solar system and excited because there's six planets here. I'm going to bounce from them. In my mind, I'm like, okay, I'm going to find life and all these resources I need. Turns out this is just a dead solar system. This is
so
a
you start
pit of hell.
Just in the outer rim.
Yeah, so there is like, yeah, everything's like ice or it's too hot for anything to grow. There's a little bit of foliage that is the same language across all planets, so you know what you can mine.
Okay.
You know, for your resources, but none of it feels unique. None of it feels like it's interesting. I'm not seeing any life. It brings up a thing. It says nothing. So I spent
flashing as an alert on your screen. Yeah, no fun. No fun.
You know, I found some runes and stuff like that, learned language, but it was like 6 hours of buzzkill. Like I was just like, oh, they weren't kidding about not seeing life. Like it's going to be rare. And then I jumped into a new solar system and it was just filled with it. So then I was like, oh, cool. But then I realized like that lull, that moment, those 5 hours of nothing happening were kind of necessary to make those discoveries feel more meaningful.
Sure, you got to have dips and valleys and whatnot.
Yeah, but I mean, it was significant, and that was just all random. Like, someone may never hit that. Every planet might be populated, or there might be people that have it worse than me. So,
but, I mean, that's just like having a losing hand every time in poker. Like, if you play the game long enough, in theory, you'll come across Dinosaur Planet, right?
Maybe, yeah. But that's the thing, is it's going to be different for everyone in those early steps, right? Like by the end of the game, when we're at that end game, I think we'll all have kind of really good understanding of it, hopefully. But right now, it's very different for everyone at the outset. And that's really interesting. But I'm liking it because of that, you know, of that, like, okay, I really do feel like an explorer. Like, I got to do better. I got to size up these planets better, look at these galaxies before I get into them and see if, you know, maybe I won't spend so much time on this planet once I see, like, its terrain and, okay, I'm just going to go back up hyperspace, find a different galaxy. But when you do find those planets where there is stuff, lots of stuff happening and it's thriving, it can be a lot of fun. Just not just like analyzing stuff and renaming it, but just watching how all the wildlife interacts. Like I found these little like kind of bunny-like Ewoks walking around. I mean, they're tiny. They're like these little like Mogwai things, right? and they're walking around and I was just like watching them just like, you know, with my thing zoomed in, the scanner zoomed in. I'm just watching. I was like, oh, he's kind of talking. You see his mouth going like, bah, 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 bah. And then all of a sudden this weird like scorpion thing kind of comes up and just starts attacking him. And I was like, oh my God, like, this is fascinating. So I just sat there for like 10 minutes and just watched all the wildlife interact. And yeah, but I mean, that's what the game's about, right? Like, the biggest hook is discovery. Like Kato said, it is a mining game at its heart. Like, you are mostly mining to upgrade your stuff or keep your systems online. That is the big gameplay thing.
So there's the grind, the economic loop. But if you want to, you can sit back and look at how pretty things are.
Yeah. I mean, that's what they want you to do. I think that's the yeah. whole point of the yeah. game is go to planets, discover what they are, move on.
Are you heading to the middle? Are you following that delineated path?
Yeah. I did the very first thing I did when I went to the pit of hell solar system was veer off of that path just to see what would happen. So I don't know if that just means like, I don't know if they have a different algorithm for that path. That's an interesting question. If it changes as you get closer.
Oh, okay.
But off the beaten path, my one instance of going there was awful.
So, we were streaming this game all of Tuesday. Kyle was down here for way too long being the explorer down yep. here. Did you join him for a little bit of that, Reiner? Sorry, you were down there for that.
Yeah, I was down there for about
a minute. Were there any highlights from that experience that stand out to you?
Probably the part I remember most was when, like, early on when we were kind of at, like, this, you know, gas station looking place. It was like somewhere between a gas station and an airport where okay. he was trying to trade his ship for another ship and he called someone down, and it was kind of like this weird sort of truck stop transaction where he was trying to sell things to get enough money to buy this ship, and then we assumed that he was gonna lose the other ship when he traded for it, but after the trade it was just there, like the ship was just still parked where he left it, so he just ran to his new ship, and then we kind of just looked at the other ship and then just flew off.
Is it like a bug, or
I don't know if that was just like a thing where it's like, yeah, I'll pick it up later, I have a tow truck, I'll go get it later. But
yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna give you a little scientific terminology, science fiction. It's called a space station.
Okay,
not a gas station.
No,
truck stop transaction.
It wasn't like one of the stations you come in and like here's like an upgrade okay. or whatever. There were a ton of chairs and it looked like an airport terminal. Uh-huh. It was an open space. There wasn't like a ceiling on it, so that's why I don't want to like say exactly space station, but it was
something like
or
that.
Like a yeah. hangar.
There was graffiti was, everywhere, holes in the bathroom
yeah,
stalls.
Exactly.
It was
everything,
confusing.
Everything was broken down. But
did it seem cool? Are you gonna be into this type of game?
I think I'm waiting on the PC version before I start playing. But after watching the stream, I was kind of like, okay, I get this loop. You know, it sounds like a very good podcast game where you can just put a podcast on and just play the game and be fine with it. But like after playing the stream, I was like, I'm not like as excited as I was. Like, I feel like I've gotten a taste of it.
Yeah.
So maybe I'll like get in on it, but like I'm not as excited as I was like before I saw everything.
It's not the final game of all final games.
Right. But.
I will say that actually in terms of soundtrack, because I had the same Ooh. Thing too, where I was like, I'll just put this game mm-hmm. on and I'll veg out and listen to something else. But there is some actually cool like sound moments or whatever, you know, certainly just when you're on the planet. But I did have kind of like a, I wouldn't call it funky, but I had some drums break out because I was being attacked. So I was on the run. It was like, oh, like I'm here in the middle of the galaxy and it's cool to know there's still like a little, you know, drum beats going.
Yeah.
You know, you hear the percussion. So that was kind of cool. You know, the thing I always do is I kind of make up this thing in my head. I call it No Man's Sky 2, which is just like, what if, you know, this first game is this whole sort of setup? Because you're running around, you're just depleting planets of their resources, just doing whatever you want. I would be kind of a funny sort of whatever if it, like the second one is like, okay, now you have to answer for your for your crimes.
That'd be nice.
Yeah.
You know, it's like this long sort of troll by Hello Games just to sort of like screw cool. with people.
I love it. Like, that'd I think awesome. People were even speculating that was going to be like Mass Effect 3. Like, all those, you know, planets that you mined yeah. in Mass Effect 2, you thought was so boring. You were like killing civilizations, taking all their precious resources away from them.
Because yeah. you're walking around and you just see like these empty, you know, I came across like some sort of outpost and there's empty chairs. And I'm like, was there a massacre here? Was there some sort of, you know, super Zika outbreak and everybody's dead? You know, you sort of making up this story as you go along, and you know, mine tend to be not very good stories.
Just
you know?
Roanoke, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, maybe we need to start the hashtag like No Man's Sky 2.
Mm.
It's just all these sort of, you know.
Yeah, get Hello Games off their lazy asses yeah. and make a new game already.
Yeah, I went into one like I don't know, just a little research station, like opened up the doors and it looked like the xenomorphs from Aliens were creating the hive in there. Like all the terminals were like covered in stuff. And I was like, whoa,
oh, that's awesome.
What's happening here? And then I didn't get any context to it. It was just this random thing.
So it seems like there's a wave of realization going across the internet after all this hype has been blown out of proportion.
They could never meet it.
Oh, impossible. Yeah. They were the first to admit that. But it seems like people are realizing, oh, it's this type of game. What were like some of the big misconceptions you think that once you started playing popped into your head?
For me, it was very much just how much resource management would be the backbone of this game. I thought it would be more about, you know, I hate to bring up this example, but you know, when Alan Grant rolls up in the Jeep in Jurassic Park and it's just this wonderful moment of just observing and taking in the atmosphere. Uh-huh. But this is more like, oh, wow. Oh, my life support's down. I'm going to fly over there. Oh, no, I'm out of gas. So you're just mining these beautiful resources, like blowing up rocks and all this.
Running and the screaming.
Yeah, and blowing up trees and whatever you can to get what you need to fuel yourself and your expedition. That's kind of frustrating. And especially from the outset of play, I don't know, Kato, if you experienced this as well, but the first couple hours for me were really tough to get into. Like, they have such a finite amount of stuff that you can carry at any time in your inventory. And it's not like Skyrim where you know, like, okay, I can wipe out this guy's kitchen and take all of his utensils and plates, but I probably shouldn't do that. I'm going to get over-encumbered. This stuff I'm never going to use. These are elements you're picking up. You don't know what they do. Like, you're just mining zinc and all this. Like, well, I should get this. I can. But then you realize, like, 2 hours later what all that stuff really does. Huh. And there's still elements in this game I still don't know what they do. And I get it, and I'm like, man, I don't have the space for this, but I should take this along maybe? So you got to make those tough choices, and they want that to be part of the experience as you go on. As you get better ships, like Kato got a second one, I got a second one, and upgrade your backpack space, it eases up on that a little bit and becomes a little bit more entertaining.
Okay.
But that's what really those first few hours are about, is just really maintaining and figuring out how to survive.
I was surprised just looking at the stream and tuning in every once in a while. Just how boring Kyle was. No, I kid. I love Kyle. No, but the amount of like NPCs. I know they had mentioned, it seemed like pretty recently, that there were going to be NPCs. Back when we were on the cover story trip, I think they said that there weren't. But how do those work? How much are they talking to you? Are they as customized and as crazy unique as the creatures? What's going on with those
things? I think I've seen two or three different species. One of them kind of looks like Reeves from Star Wars, the guy with the three eyes. But this one had four. Another is the Gek, right? That's the name of this species.
So there's like a set. No, it's not the infinite variety of like the creatures.
They're varied though. Like one will have a metal chin, or you know, one will have a different kind of scalp or something. Like,
so they're not conveying like a story really. They're just like traders.
They're just merchants, but they do give you kind of a, sometimes they'll ask you a question.
Yeah.
Or they'll the language thing, right?
Yeah. And that's tied into learning the language, which is something that's really cool about the game, where you're going out and finding words, individual words. I know that sounds silly, but you'll get something like spawn. And it's like, when am I ever going to talk about spawn in a conversation? But then you'll see someone talking and it'll be gibberish, 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 spawn, gibberish, gibberish. And you're like, oh, and then you get three responses and you're like, trying to match it up. Like, okay, one of these is going to be a successful answer that will get me something.
That's cool. It's like the alphabet in Final Fantasy X, I don't remember. So they're transcoding that. Or even like, I guess they had that with Rise of the Tomb Raider too, like learning Greek or whatever. That, I think that's a fun system.
But one of them pointed me to, just real quick, pointed me to a crashed ship like on the planet that I got to go explore. So stuff like that's neat.
Yeah, I would say that's one of the components that is, to me, the most pleasantly surprising from, you know, when we started hearing about the game, was just how much sort of lore is built out into the game. And I don't know if this is like the beginning of a story or a storyline, but you get these little nuggets of information. And the fact that, I mean, we've encountered that all the time in video games, right? You pick up some item and it's some, or an audio log, and it's just some whatever. And you're like, okay, somebody, some developer, you know, wrote this out in his lunch hour and that's it. But in this world, when we're expecting all this procedurally generated stuff, when you're expecting not to run into anybody else, you know, like I said, I don't know if this hints to larger stories, but the fact that they've clearly taken the time at certain points to write in a bunch of this stuff is pretty cool, and is definitely not one of the things I was expecting.
Yeah, I'm excited to see it. It's really fun to, like, I have a page where I can see all of our YouTube comments, and those YouTube videos from No Man's Sky cover story, like, they're the most successful YouTube videos as far as like a bunch of cover stories that we've ever done. It's absurd how many people are still looking at those things. And the comments have all just been like, Sean Murray, lead developer, have my children. Like, Sean Murray's the 14th doctor. Oh, you're the best, Sean. And then it's slowly changing. Like when the murmurings and rumblings of this game actually hitting. And now that it's out, it's just, Sean, you lied. I know where you live. Like, it's just crazy negative. Everyone just be like, no man's lie. Because like in one of those videos, I think it's the 70 questions with Jeff Cork. Jeff Cork says like, can you play with your friends? And Sean's like, yes. And now everyone is just in an uproar about this game not being as multiplayer focused as they all thought, because two people went to the same place and they didn't see each other. But I feel like Hello Games from way back then, even very clear, like this is not an MMO. Everyone's not in the same world, but they've also been a little bit cagey about exactly what multiplayer is.
Yeah, why not just come forward at this point and say it? Like, pitchforks and torches are out.
Yeah.
Just the game is out. Like, tell us. Just give us a straight answer if you can. Like,
why can't
these people see each other?
But I feel like we wrote a blowout feature during the cover story trip. Ryan Vohr wrote it, where it's just an interview talking about their plans for multiplayer back in 2014. And even back then, they said, like, don't think of it as a multiplayer game. This is going to be an instanced world. And we asked him, like, how many people are in an instance? And he's like, I don't want to say. But
it did very clearly say you will see the other player.
You will
That's the only way you'll see what a character looks like.
Right. And so I think the debate is whether or not that's still in the game fully. Yeah. They say like, oh, you'll see, you will have an impact from other players, but people don't know if that's just the name or there's some Easter eggs, which I think in his update, he said that there are Easter eggs in multiplayer that people don't really understand. But the question is that instancing still in the game? Because it's like, if you coordinate with a friend and go to the same spot, you probably won't see each other, but maybe you're still in the world with technically some other people and you will see something that they have done or still see them.
Right.
It's just astronomical because of the instancing on top of the size of the galaxy. So who the hell knows? What do you guys think about this reaction and negativity towards them on the multiplayer front?
I just think they got to come forward and just be clean, you know, straightforward with people and just say, hey, like them not answering right away made me think there might be something wrong with the game. And he was tweeting a lot like, there's too many people playing the game. I can't believe discoveries are still happening. And I was just kind of like, this is really weird information to be delivering at this point. Like, they should write a blog post, a big blog post about what is going on with the game at this moment. What happened in this instance with these two people? Because they're the only people that can answer that.
Isn't there some value, though, in like keeping it cryptic and keeping it mysterious? I think a lot of people want to bring out the pitchfork because it's like, you sold us a bill of goods. But I think in their defense, they were just trying to build up the mystery around this game a little bit just for fun. That's the thrill of creating a universe.
The mystery vanished when they were on top of each other, when the people are supposedly on top of each other. At that point, then it's like, wait, there's nothing else we can do. We found each other. Like, we're trying to reach out and, you know, make contact. This is such a big moment in a sci-fi universe.
So,
and then it's just nothing.
Do you think it would help to like put a blog post out with like, hey, here are the exact numbers? It's like, hey, the instances, they have four people. Good luck finding each other. And explain it that way, or just explain the concept of instancing again.
I think they need to go into exactly what happened in this one and why they were ghosts.
Right.
And then talk about how they, you know, what the example would be if they would see each other then.
And maybe just put a little carrot out there for people to be like, it's not impossible.
Yeah.
But it's kind of fun, though, in the same way that the reviews aren't out, that people are still trying to figure out how exactly this game is stitched together. And a lot of people have mentioned, Dantek included, who's maybe a little bit more on the negative side, saying like, oh, once this game's out on PC, people are going to tear it open and find out all these details immediately. Yeah. And I know that Hello Games was really worried about that on the cover story trip. They didn't want people digging through the archive of their baby, but of course.
You know what? A little bit of devil's advocate here is, you know, while certainly people want answers, and, you know, maybe they're thinking I was pre-ordered the game and, you know, the information that was out there before caused me to pre-order the game, or I bought it based on some other information. I understand there's a very strong consumer sort of feelings. I don't want to put those aside. But I would say that in service of the artist, so to speak, that, you know, you could certainly argue that no answers, you know, are really owed at all. I mean, this is their creation. They can stand or fall by it. If you don't like the ambiguity and, you know, the way they aren't answering it, then you don't, you know, you certainly don't have to buy it. You know, if you already bought it, I guess, you know, that's a tough situation. But, you know, I think there's something to be said for if they want to do this and they want to kind of go down this road, maybe in the service of the mystery of their product or you know, whatnot, then if they want to sort of, like I said, stand or fall by it, then I think that's kind of their prerogative. I mean, the thought of somebody owing something in that sense, I think, is a little bit of our recent, you know, social media sort of pitchfork philosophy, but, you know.
I'll agree to that, but, I mean, if I was in their camp and I was working on the game and just seeing these people put their life on hold to try to figure this out and just keep experimenting, I'd feel awful for just not answering that question if I knew the answer.
It's also weird because, like, I feel like it's very difficult for them to communicate because their answer is effectively, like, is there multiplayer in the game? Technically, but no.
Right.
Yeah, you don't even need to be connected online.
Yeah, so...
But you said technically there's a chance.
Right, that's the problem, is that people are hanging on to that chance of there being multiplayer. But to be fair, like, people found that chance, mm-hmm. and it didn't work. So mm-hmm. that I think they are specifically on the hook for that one moment, because I don't know. That's maybe the thing that they didn't communicate, like, very well. Everything else I feel like is, well, the information was out there. It's just you guys misinterpret it. But that one detail, I think, is super important.
And just the base description you give people, you know, people that aren't plugged into news, is like, you're all exploring a galaxy together, discovering it. So right there, you're just instantly thinking, we're all in this together.
Mm-hmm.
That seems unified, but that's not the case.
Well, do you know if the planet naming is instanced, or is that communal?
That is communal if you upload it, right? I think that's...
Okay, so you have to
periodically if I, like, name something and you stumble upon it, it will be, you know, that planet, it will be named what I named it.
Yeah. Here's an impossible question to answer. This game's been out for a couple days. What's its legacy? What is this thing going to look like 6 months from now? Are people still going to be playing it? Are there going to be those crazy fans that are as into it as they thought they'd be?
I think so. You know, the size of that group, you know, who knows what it could be. It could end up being a big phenomenon, or it could be just a relatively small amount of people who really just fall for it. And, you know, my personal thought, because, you know, I kind of started out the show talking about, okay, you know, I understand the fundamental mm-hmm. resource loop, you know, what's sort of next. But my basic feeling is that, you know, you can't take away that moment I felt when I, you know, first started the game and I was looking around the planet and I, you know, found this. Or you can't take away that situation I had where I was on a planet and I got to feed an animal and then had a little smiley face over it and he went and showed me some resources, brought me over to some resources and was like, all right, thanks, bud. I mean, like...
And then you shot him and took his resource
just to watch him bleed.
And used him as a resource.
Yeah, and if you actually find my character, you see him, I'll have a dead pelt on my...
Oh, perfect. Yeah, so crudely stitched together.
But, you know, regardless of what I think about the game, what I would score, all that sort of stuff, or, you know, how I think, let's say, you know, 10 weeks from now when I play the game, those are the moments I'm going to remember. And so the fact that, you know, that those moments happened, and, you know, out of all the games you've played, there's probably not a lot of games that there's going to have those moments that maybe you remember forever. To me, I'm, you know, satisfied. It's kind of a loaded word, but, like, you can't take those memories away from me, and I'm always going to enjoy them. So in that sense, you know, I've loved the game.
Yeah. We should point out that Matt Miller is reviewing it. He's at home right now and recording this podcast. So a final verdict is coming from Game Informer and whatnot. I hear you.
Yeah, I would say I think everybody was excited for this game. And then the second I started playing it and feeling like I started drowning in it, I was like, uh-oh. Like, I think there is a lot of people that will be like, I've never played a game with resource management like this before, and that is what it's all about, and they're going to hate it. So I think there is going to be a very big group saying, no, I didn't like it, and then a very big group this is my type of game.
Well, hey, speaking of the role of the artist in video games, we should talk about Abzu a little bit. You reviewed this a while ago. It came out a couple weeks ago, Kato, but we haven't had a chance to get you on. You like this game a lot.
I did.
This is a giant squid. It's like an offshoot from that game company, mm-hmm. and it's the art director from Journey. Is that right?
Yeah, Matt Nava, and also Austin Wintry, who also worked at the soundtrack for Journey.
Yeah.
It did a great job on the soundtrack for Abzu.
Yeah, for sure. So what do you like about this game?
I like about it, you know, we talked about relaxation, and it's a beautiful game. And I think, you know, talking about those moments that some video games have and some video games don't, this one definitely has, you know, a connection with animals, a connection with nature, which I think happens pretty organically, no pun intended. And it's a very powerful feeling that I got through the game. To the point where, you know, I like the game. When I look at it sort of critically, there was some things I have thought maybe were against it. And one of those maybe is that, like, the story, I understand it. It certainly guides you through, you know, the game. It's not, you know, some people wonder if like, well, what do I do? I'm here, but then what am I really doing? That thread does carry you, but I wouldn't say that's as strong of a thread as just the fundamental, that fundamental connection with nature. So it's great that it could execute that and provide that feeling and that understanding. But at the same time, it's like, you know, is the story necessary? Is it, you know, are the other components, do they really build on that and sort of better that fundamental feeling? It's kind of like, I don't know. It's kind of like when you have a multiplayer game, you really love the multiplayer and you think, I'm here having a great time with this multiplayer because I'm here with my buddy, we're on the couch and we're playing. It's like, well, how much of that is a game and how much of that is you having fun with, you know what
sure,
I mean?
Sure, like, yeah.
They didn't invent, you know, Nintendo didn't invent, let's say when you're playing Mario Party, they didn't invent having stupid fun with your dumb friends, you know what I mean? So,
and in this case, your friends
long
are fish?
Long analogy, yeah. But my point being is that, like, that connection with nature, that's great that they did it, but again, the story parts of it and how that connects up maybe isn't the strongest part of that.
Yeah, and even, like, I finished it last night, and mechanically it's even less gamey than Journey. Yeah. Journey had, like, extending scarf, you could go at a certain distance. There were threats in Journey, even if it wasn't, like, a health bar, but, like, the giant kind of snaky things and whatnot that would knock you out. There's still kind of a sense of danger in Abzu, but it's a little bit even more of a peaceful meditation type of thing.
Okay, so you say there's a connection to nature. Now, is that you're just observing, or are you like riding a dolphin with like suckerfish on your nipples? Like,
it's basically it. It's a lot
there's
of nipple
a
play
button to like hang on to any fish nearby, basically.
Yeah,
yeah. So but you are interacting with them. Okay, yeah.
I did it a couple times. I was like, these guys are just like tough to steer. Some of the aggressive ones will eat other fish, which is cool. But most of the time, I was like, I'm just going to swim on my own. Leave me alone.
Yeah,
fish.
Like
grabbing
a
shark
directionlessly.
Yeah,
so
maybe.
You if you want to get to where you need to go, you kind of have to not do that.
Right, but it's the game is always gently pushing you. There's literally like these meditation rocks where you sit down. And it's like, hey, just look at the pretty fish, everybody. Ride the fish around. And every once in a while, like it's stunning. Like there's one section, I don't know, maybe like halfway through the game or so, where you go into this room and it is hundreds, thousands of smaller fish just swirling into school. You've seen like little pockets in schools of fish before, but like just the tech of seeing those fish, it looks so good. It was really one of the most striking moments of the year for me so far in game. It was like this game that I wrap my head around technically. Suddenly I went into this new room and was like, holy God, there's a lot of fish swirling around in here. It looks awesome.
How long is it?
Not long.
I beat it.
Is it like one sitting, like meditative?
Yeah.
Like
It's Journey, yes.
That was
maybe even shorter than Journey. Okay. Yeah, 2 hours.
I played it before work yesterday, and then I beat it when I got home.
Okay.
So it wasn't like, it's maybe two and a half hours.
Were you banging on the controller as hard as you're banging on the fight sticks in the office?
No.
You're playing Abzu? Oh, okay.
Although, to be fair, like, you gotta hit those buttons hard if you wanna do the combos.
Hey, man, you wanna do those combos. You spent so much time in test rooms in fighting
games.
Okay,
It was not the test room, it was a trial mode.
It's all
a game
same.
I can't talk about.
A game you can't talk about.
I came in this morning and you got the stick in your lap and you're just like, and then you kind of leaned back like this, and I was like, nope, I'm not going to talk to him. I just walked away. I was just like, I don't even know what he's doing.
It
just
has turned
weird fighting game
the
stuff.
The entire back bullpen is just... just like...
Yeah, They make quieter buttons, but they're more expensive.
You would love Mike Futter and his mechanical keyboard. You guys should get in the same room and just blow
windows. I have a
mechanical
keyboard at home.
Ah, you are one of those guys. All right.
They feel nice. I like the feel of a mechanical keyboard.
We all do. We all do.
I guess it's also worse
because... Popcorn in a microwave and hear the same thing.
I mean, they're a little, the sounds are a little more organized, but...
Sure. That's true.
Yeah.
I said a little more.
A little more. Abzu, it's fascinating to me. Like, I love Journey. I started out a little bit as a skeptic because I was following so many interviews with Jenova Chen, the creative director for that game, and he was just very much saying, I love Team Ico. I love Ueda. I want to make a game like that. And it's like, all right, good luck, California boy. Let's see how this goes. And then Journey ended up being like, wow, this is majestic. Like, it's awe-inspiring in moments. And it was really impressive that they pulled it off. And now this is an offshoot where the art director is basically saying, I want to make Journey again. And so in some ways it feels like a knockoff of a knockoff, and it didn't inspire that majesty in me.
It's all based on realism, right? Like, you're in a typical ocean scene.
This is not
there's
endless
some weird
ocean.
Stuff in there. There's some surrealist
imagery.
Okay,
because I was going to say, everything I've seen is just like, hey, there's a clownfish.
No, it gets trippy.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's the highlight of the game for me is those stranger moments when everything gets bizarre. But... just to follow down this, like, I know knockoff is a negative term, but it is bizarre how much of Journey they took and just shoved into that. And especially like for such a like bold little game to then like mirror that structure exactly for another game. It's so strange. Like, I mean, they have the hieroglyphics, they have like the quicksand moments when you're in a tunnel of water this time around, when it's like the music really blares.
Right.
I would say though that the, you know, kind of touching on what Reiner's asking about, I mean, the technology that you'd mentioned before with the bait ball, the technology for the fish and for the ecosystem and stuff, I do think that is a much larger background than some of the things you have for Journey. I mean, I love Journey, and I would say actually I think I like Journey more than this game, and Journey's one of my favorite games of all time. But I would say that one of the differentiating factors of Abzu is the tech that they went and, you know, the effort they put behind that, because you're talking about the meditation points. I mean, when you're on there and just, you know, watching things, that is an I think a strong aspect of the game in and of itself that wouldn't be there without the effort they put in to create the ecosystem and the predation, and, you know, a lot of that sort of stuff.
I think I still like the look of Journey a little bit more. Like, the sand in that game still looks fantastic. And there's something about the character in Abzu having little googly eyes that throws me off a little bit. Still, like, if you like Journey, and especially if you've never owned a PlayStation system, this is a great way to experience that game company game. Style game, which is weird to say that there's that game company template now.
Yeah.
Hey, what the hell is that game company up to? It's been so long. Genova Chen is, in theory, still there, but he's just been under the radar, and I hope they're building something new and big.
We want to make a game like Abzu, is what they're going to say.
Perfect. Abzu, but like above ground. About damn time. Cool. That's Abzu. I'm glad you liked it, Kato. I enjoyed it too. Like, don't take it as I'm being negative towards it. It's a cool experience. It just felt like it made me appreciate what Journey did better, I think.
Yeah, you know, I don't know if anybody noticed, but I purposely didn't mention Journey, and I didn't actually talk about Journey in my review, and part of that was, you know, my own sort of writing ego. It was kind of an exercise for myself. It's like, how can let's define this game on its own. And but that was the other part of it too, is I felt like, you know, that's an easy sort of route to take, and it's an understandable one. Mm-hmm. I totally get it, but I wanted to try to define it on its own. So, you know, Journey is an apt comparison, but I do feel that there's, you know, enough difference there that I think, you know, you'll be attracted to it for those reasons, but I wouldn't just dismiss it as, you know, a copycat.
Totally. Reiner, I haven't talked to you at all about QuakeCon.
Sure.
You were there last week.
Yeah, just got back this weekend.
What was the most exciting thing you saw there?
Prey.
So they showed gameplay from Prey.
I saw, I want to say probably 7 minutes of actual gameplay. They released a trailer that's just like brief snippets of it.
Okay.
But I actually got to see, like, you know, environment navigation, combat, using powers in different ways.
So we saw stuff at E3. Was that just CG then?
That was all CG. Morgan waking up, going to the mirror, checking his eye.
Yeah.
And then by the end of it, you know, it's bloody and you're like, what's going on there? We now have context to that. We know what's going on. And I'll just say this. After I watched those 7 minutes, I immediately thought of Bioshock. Not because it's similar in a dystopian setting, you know, the high and mighty, these rich people did experiments, did something terrible to themselves.
Okay.
That is the same, right? That setting is the same. But just seeing weapons and powers be used in unique ways in kind of a story-driven environment like that reminded me of Bioshock. And they're doing some really cool stuff in Prey that sets it apart from other games.
I'm excited for it. So this is Arkane Austin.
Yes.
Which is confusing. So they co-developed the first Dishonored and whatnot, another split.
Harvey went across the big ocean, and Raph stayed here and started working on this with Ricardo Bear.
Ricardo Bear, yeah, he was the lead designer then on Dishonored. So what stands out to you? You say it's doing some cool things.
Yeah, so a couple things. Like, the thing that's happening to Morgan Yu, the main character, who can be either male or female, you don't get to design them, it's just a template, male or female, is that he or she has been experimented on and with alien DNA. So they're doing weird stuff to your body, injecting it into your brain and all this stuff. And something terrible happens. The space station is lost and aliens are running amok. People are dying left and right. You wake up at that kind of ground zero moment and your memory's gone. You don't know what's happened, but you do have these kind of alien powers within you, and you get more as the game goes along. But one you have that we saw right away is Mimic. And it was funny because the demo started and the guy's got a wrench. It's very Bioshock, but he's got a wrench.
Okay.
And he goes up these kind of golden stairs and this trash can comes rolling down and he kind of like freaks out. And it almost looks like it's a jump scare moment, but it's not. And he like hits the trash can with the wrench and it kind of moves aside. And I was like, well, that's a weird moment to do in the game.
Uh-huh.
And then Raph says like, he did that because enemies can take shape of anything.
Oh, that's so awesome.
So as he's going through the demo again, you then see like there's a trash can in the corner and he's got a gun and he shoots it. And it's again, still a trash can, you know, like, so it's like he's freaking out over just inanimate objects in the environment. But since he has the power of Mimic, he can do the same thing. So Morgan comes to this locked door and there's no way in. And he's like looking around like, how do I get in here? There's like a little bank teller window or, you know, like ammo provider or whatever. That's the opening is just like, I don't know, 6 inches high by like 8 inches. He's looking at that, looking around, and then there's a coffee mug right on the counter. And he mimics the coffee mug and it turns into almost like a Pixar moment of like a bouncing coffee mug.
And he is person?
Yes, he is the coffee mug, kind of like Dishonored turning into the rats or whatever. Like
Beauty and the Beast characters.
But then he rolls as the coffee mug through the opening, down under the floor, transforms back into a human. And right there, I was just like, oh my God, this is crazy.
Done. Sold. That sounds awesome.
That's great.
And so then gameplay terms, I mean, would you be able to, is it strictly defined in the environment what you can and
anything that's not bolted down? So I talked to Ricardo afterwards. He said that there's been moments where the player goes into a room and mimics a chair and a mimic comes in the room and mimics a chair and they're having a stare down of chairs. But then it becomes like they can't like bash into each other and do that. But it's like whoever transforms first and gets the other then is like, you know, like so that's the encounter.
How does it not? I mean, I can't imagine that big of a threat we'd want to do this. But isn't the temptation then just to go through the game and just bang with a wrench on every object you
yeah.
see? Like, how do you stop players?
I'm wondering
doing
if you'll see something like just kind of rattle a little or something that will start freaking you out.
Oh, that's so good.
And they said it's all random. They said like they, you know, spawn. They tell the enemies when to spawn these mimics, when to spawn. But then it's up to them, whatever they want to do and as their AI. So anything in the environment, they could take over if they want, or they could just run in their physical form. So they just, you know, every time they play test it, they say they see something different and crazy.
Is this just one class of alien or all the aliens mimics then?
No, that's just one type. There's like these little spider ones and all the aliens are really cool looking. They almost look like distortions or like kind of smoky figures with like glowing white eyes. Like you can't really make them out. You could tell it's like a bipedal organism or like a spider-like thing, but it's always shifting.
Love it.
Almost like they're smoke or kind of like dissolving venom, you know, from Spider-Man. But another thing we saw is he got this gun called the glue cannon, G-L-O-O. And okay. There's like 5 spiders coming at him. And it looks like, again, like something from Bioshock that's like steampunky cobbled together. And he shoots it and shoots out this foam and it instantly freezes all of them. And then he switches to the alt, which is like a napalm launcher or flamethrower. And he just, this glue, apparently, this foam is apparently incendiary. And just, they go up in a blaze.
And so like, it's just the thing, like torching little thinglings?
Yeah. And it was just like this huge that's flame. Cool. And I was like, that's awesome. But then he's like, you can also use the guns in different ways. And he sprays foam up a wall, up to a balcony. And then he goes up, climbs up on the glue, the foam stuff, and uses that for traversal. So it has kind of like that Metroid-esque, like finding different areas using your powers. I was just like, oh my God, this looks so cool.
That is awesome. Yeah. I did not know any of this.
Because they didn't show it in the trailer.
I didn't even watch that. Okay.
It was like the trailer seemed very simple compared to that.
Yeah, you have not seen the gameplay. The gameplay is sweet, sweet,
which is funny because they build it as a gameplay reveal and it was just like, here's the guy walking through a space station and here's, you know, him shooting things with guns, which is like fine, but it's not turning into a coffee cup. It's not shooting foam.
Yeah.
Like they should have shown that in the trailer because that would have, I think, gotten people a lot more excited.
But I wonder if people just say then, oh, this is the coffee cup game. Like it's such a weird thing to get out of the gate with actual gameplay.
Can you
mimic people? Can you mimic the spiders? Can you mimic the aliens?
That's a good question. I don't know. But other things, I mean, there's so many cool instances of just like weapons being, I could talk your ear off of the weapons they showed us, like grenades and kind of, I don't know, these kind of shockwave beams that you could send out to pause time, how that can be comboed together. And you loot bodies and you're getting minerals and resources that you use in these machines to build stuff. So we see him build a zero-G propulsion system with stuff he cobbled together. And he goes over to this machine and it makes a form like a 3D printer kind of. And he uses that to go out and spacewalk. And it turns out that the entire complex, the entire space station you're on, Talos 1, is open. And he's like, I don't want to call it open world, but you can kind of go where you want to. And I was like, so you can just go out and spacewalk and find different doors? He's like, yeah, if you want to. There will be progression blocks where you need certain powers or whatever, but you can just kind of go out and roam and explore the space station. And he's like, it's loaded with, there's only one mission in the game, but there's tons of side quests. But there's one big thing you're trying to do, and you get that mission right from the outset.
Mimic a cup.
Exactly. But he's like, you can get lost in these side stories and doing missions for other people and stuff like that, or these little quests, but there's just one goal. And I'm not sure what it is, if it's kind of like Judge Dredd, get to the top floor or whatever, but I don't know. It sounds very cool, very unique, and the gameplay we saw was very impressive. Like, the combat looked great, and the powers, again, like the both of them being used in different ways was super cool and gave me that feeling of, I have not seen gameplay like this before, and I want to experiment with it.
As fun and experimental as like when we first saw Dishonored, it was like, oh, combining these powers is gonna be really cool.
Yeah, or just like seeing Dishonored. Yeah, that's a good example.
Yeah.
And it's Arcane, you know, so it's like their thing. But the dystopian setting and all that is very, I mean, a lot of people are going to draw comparisons to Bioshock, I think.
And I know
that's a good thing.
Yeah. Sean Elliott, who is a designer of Bioshock Infinite, is over there now. I'm sure there's a lot of crossover in that team and whatnot after, you know, Irrational's implosion. Anything else come close to that from QuakeCon? What else did they have? Quake.
Yeah. Quake Champions. So they showed a brief trailer of that, and then at the finals party, they do kind of tournaments throughout QuakeCon. They did one match, and it kind of didn't go over so well because the match before it in Quake Live was so good, it went to 7 overtimes.
Oh, okay.
And people were losing. There's like 3,000 people in an auditorium losing their minds over this, and they're like, now Quake Champions. And it was just like, good luck. But when they demoed it for the first time, they started out by showing the speed of the game, and people are like clapping and cheering, like, yeah, speed.
Faster.
It's so much faster than than Doom. Yeah, this is what we want. This is Quake speed. And they're like, then the rocket jumps back. Yeah, the rocket jumps back. Yeah, it looks like Quake. And then they're like, and now all characters have a unique power. And everybody's like,
hero gameplay.
Why are you doing hero stuff? We'll have to wait and see. So there's a lot of question marks about, are they destroying what Quake is by adding this element? We'll see. That's the big question. We won't know until the beta hits next year.
Okay. It's so fascinating to be like, to think of, well, the market demands, or it looks like people like hero-based gameplay. What are you going to do? But then it feels like all anecdotal enthusiasm, just like,
yeah,
heroes, get out of here. Just give me Quake.
And what they were showing was like, I was like, whoa, this could be significant. Like the powers that people have in that game. And one guy even has just like this crazy charge ability where he just like Rhino from Spider-Man runs. We're just going to keep comparing everything to Spider-Man. But just runs and just charges and blows guys up like into giblets as he goes through them.
Jeez.
Or giblets, whatever you call it.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I mean, it graphically, it looks good. You know, it's the id Tech stuff. So they know what they're doing over there, but we'll have to see about that character class stuff.
Well, wait. I saw in the trailer, and the gameplay trailer looked better than I thought, for sure. It said, like, an id game in the beginning.
But it's made by, I can't remember who the dev is, but it is their engine, I believe. And
That's a little misleading to say.
It is very incorporated into the dev of that, for sure.
Okay. All right. Huh. It seemed like the real star of the show, outside of Prey and Quake, was Overcooked, though.
That's right. Yeah. So, real quick, QuakeCon, the big draw is not going to see new games or the tournaments, but the BYOC, which is this huge, sprawling, hangar-like room where 3,000, 4,000 people set up their computers. There's no lighting in there. It's just the glow from the monitors.
Awesome.
But they bring all their rigs, and they just play games day and night. And it's like security's great, where you can just leave your stuff set up, go to your hotel room or wherever people go at night. And but as you're walking through there, you're like, okay, people are playing Overwatch. They're playing WoW, League of Legends, DOTA. And then all of a sudden you start seeing like these groups of people getting really loud and rowdy. And you're looking and it's like this top-down weird isometric game. And you're like, what is that? And it's like, are they cooking? And it, you know, they're yelling out, I need meat over here. I need some buns. You know, it's
chop like, that onion.
Yeah. And then you find out they're playing this kind of little indie game called Overcooked that is a four-player local co-op cooking game where you're all running a kitchen together and trying to get as many orders out the door before the timer is up. And I got to tell you, it starts out, you're like, okay, this is pretty simple. But by level 3, they have you on a pirate ship cooking, because it's the end of days, by the way. I'll get into this, but you're on a pirate ship cooking, and the ship starts swaying, and everything in the kitchen starts moving. So you're like next to the oven, like, okay, this onion soup's going to be up in a second. And all of a sudden, the counter and everything starts moving. You're getting pushed away from it, and it starts on fire. And it's like, we got a fire.
There's no one on that side.
So it becomes very chaotic, but it has a campaign. This game has a campaign where it's like fireballs are raining down upon this metropolis. You're four cooks up on top of a building, and you find out like you got to learn how to cook to save off the devil. Like, he's here. You got to make him the best meal ever. But to do that, you got to go all the way across the world, get every kind of food possible. And that takes you just to the craziest locations, like a pirate ship and stuff like that.
And the world looks so... I played it last night. I absolutely love this game, too. Played it for a couple hours. But the world map, it's basically a little bit like the 3D world map or like Mario, except it has like this great tilt shift look. It kind of looks like Fortnite's world map, which I know a lot of people haven't seen, but I hope they do in the future. And then you just drive around and go to like 1-1, 1-2, 1-3. And there's like a full campaign for this co-op experience, which is pretty unique.
Yeah, and don't play it single player, though. If it sounds intriguing, I tried playing it single player, and it's like, this is 100% a co-op game. Like, it just doesn't have that flavor without it.
And it feels, it's like a Space Team level of chaos. Everyone's screaming out. And like, I cannot imagine a world where people can half-heart this, go in half-heartedly if they're playing with four people. Because like, after every mission, my friends and I are just like, all right, let's get serious here. We need to assign roles because that order was messed up. And I was waiting on lettuce for that burger for way too long. And then you try and assign roles, and then the next level, they shake it up just enough. Like, it's that constant variety so you can never get comfortable. And like, it is comfortably pushing everybody into chaos over and over and over again. And it's so well done. Yeah. Like, the art, the music, ugh.
And there'll be things where it's like the counter space just allows one body to slide through it, and you're like, oh no. Like, because then you obviously see someone coming with like a dirty dish and another guy coming with a burger, and it's just like, get out of my way!
I need to watch this plate, you idiot! It's really awesome. Yeah, if you need a good local co-op game.
Yeah, Xbox One, PS4, PC.
Yeah, it's one of the most entertaining co-op games I've played in a long time.
I think
sure.
It's $20, but I think on Xbox One it's on sale right now for like $13 or something like that. So,
fun deal.
Yeah.
No-brainer.
Absolute no-brainer.
Hey, Suriel, speaking of food, go back to cereal here. Metroid 2. Tell us about this game on the Game Boy from 1991.
Well, I never really played it, seen some videos of it, but I am playing the it's called Another Metroid 2 Remake. It is the technical name for it, but it's basically it's Another Metroid 2 Remake. It's a fan remake, which is why it got pulled from the internet mostly. There was I was trying to find it, and Joe Jubba ended up giving me like a copy that he downloaded.
Okay.
But yeah, it's a really thorough remake of Metroid 2, and at one point I got stuck in it. So like, this is basically like exactly like Super Metroid in terms of looks. I want to say it's using either like assets that are directly from Zero Mission, the Game Boy game, or he like redrew them and they look very similar. But so it's like a complete skin over the entire game, and the map isn't like one-to-one, but at one point I got stuck and I looked up a map from the original.
Oh,
and
weird.
I was like, and the shapes were very similar. So I was like, okay, I know I'm here. So, and there's this thing I need to get over here. And so like, it wasn't in like exactly the same place as far as from looking at the map anyway, but I was able to find where I needed to go to proceed from looking at a map of the old one. So
yeah,
that's about as close as it is. And yeah, it's a really good like Metroid game. It's really well paced. Like, you're getting missile expansions every few minutes. There's I want to say I'm about 4 hours into it. In terms of game time, but like, I'm sure I've spent about an hour looking at the map and menus and stuff. It doesn't count that.
Yeah.
But it's just you. It's structured really interestingly because instead of like, okay, here's this one area and then you're constantly like moving back and forth, I've started to see like it's basically this one tower with spokes coming off of it. Mm-hmm. And the way it works is that this is like, I haven't played all of the Metroid games, but this is like the one game where you're fighting a ton of Metroids.
Okay.
And so the way it works is that you'll descend a little bit towards this one central path, and then there'll be a spoke off of it. And in this book, it'll say, oh, there are readings here, and there are X number of Metroids you need to kill in this area. It doesn't tell you that directly, but it says there are X, because the whole point of the game is you have to kill every Metroid on the planet.
Just genocide for Metroids?
Yeah, and there's a counter on the screen that says you have X number of Metroids left to kill.
Okay.
So you go into an area, and it tells you, okay, we have found X Metroids in this area. And it, again, doesn't make this explicit, but when you kill all the Metroids in the area, like... the lava level lowers a little bit. Like there are things that are obstructing your way that leave basically as soon as you're done with all the Metroids in that area. So you just go from one area, and then now after you beat that one area, you go a little bit lower, and there's another spoke to the side, and you fight more Metroids, and they add more Metroids every time. But the cool thing about it is that I've only encountered like two types of Metroids. There's like a small one and a big one that you fight, but they basically have this one enemy that you fight, and they put you in a room with it in every possible formation of that room. So there'll be this really claustrophobic room where you have to basically run back and forth and try to jump away from it. And there's this one room where you fight it, and it's like this really long vertical tower. And there's one room where you're running across a bridge, and then the bridge collapses, and then spikes start coming out of the floor. And by that time, you have the space jump. So you're basically like jumping all over the place.
That's awesome.
In this big room. So it's like, it's a really good example of like, here's what level design can do for your game. Because it's here's the same enemy over and over again, but we're going to make the fight interesting by moving things around and having you fight the same Metroid in different places.
It's such a cool idea to take, like, I think there are probably defenders out there of Metroid 2 and the Game Boy, but it was a little bit slower. It's chugging on that hardware. It was really zoomed in, but I'm sure it's still like brilliant Metroid level layout and game design, like you mentioned. And just to take that and liberate it from that system unofficially and illegally, it's awesome that people get to re-experience this. Now if people pass on that Game Boy one, to be like, oh my god, here's a new Metroid game.
It feels like I had to continue to remind myself, like, this is technically illegal what they did, but because it is that close, it looks basically exactly like a Metroid game. There's one still early on in the game where they're telling you the story of like, oh, they needed someone to kill a bunch of Metroids, and they said, well, Samus kills Metroids, I guess. And there's one still of her where she looks completely fine, like her big like various suit or whatever. It's got the big shoulders, but she's got this tiny little arm.
What?
They didn't draw it correctly is what I'm saying. It's okay. Like it looks tiny compared to the rest of her body.
Don't look at her little arm.
Yeah. but other than that, like this looks immaculate, and you can tell like this, you can tell why it took 10 years to make this game, because there's a bunch of different options. There's like, okay, do you want the missile to be toggle or hold? Do you want the aiming style to be like Super Metroid or Zero Mission?
Okay,
and he has like all these different options that you can customize the game with, and that feels like, okay, this is obviously like this huge, enormous labor of love that took him a really long time to make. So I've been enjoying it as much as I did, you know, something like Zero Mission and the half of Super Metroid that I played before I was unable to continue playing it. But
so if you want, hunt it down, copy that floppy.
Yeah.
Meet in a back alley somewhere and get a zip drive with...
You'll probably have to ask someone at this point, because like there are people have been putting up like, here's the media fire, here's the torrent, here's the Google Drive, and every time it gets taken down. So it's definitely... Like, I'm really lucky that Joe had that copy, because otherwise I wouldn't have been able to play it. I'm glad I did, because it's fantastic.
What other Game Boy games would you like to see given this treatment? I was just thinking, like...
The first one I thought of was the Metal Gear Solid.
Yeah, totally. And, like, remake it, like, in the Metal Gear Solid 1 style.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh,
yeah.
That'd be so cool. Get on it, Konami. Or fans of Konami. I don't know. Not endorsing anything. But I'm trying to think, like, 6 golden coins, I think, plays pretty well for Mario game, but it'd still be cool to see it with, like, Mario 3 physics or Mario World, you know?
I remember there being, like, a Bugs Bunny series on there, like Crazy Carrot or something like that.
Trouble?
No, there was three of them that people were all over those.
Really?
Yeah.
And just to see that, like,
I gotta bring those
remastered
up on replay. Yeah, I just want to see what those were again. But yeah, for some reason that came to mind.
Liberate the Game Boy games, everybody, one at a time.
Bring
we'll
them
free
back.
Those prisoners. All right, also TI6, real quick.
Yeah, the international.
DOTA
The big DOTA tournament, which with the $20 million prize pool.
That's it?
Jeez, oh,
yeah, at this point, I think each player on the winning team gets over $1 million, which is, like, insane. It was insane when they did it, like, 2 years ago, when it was, like, that's when the prize pool, like, skyrocketed. But it is still insane now, and yeah, those have been some really good matches. Like, I don't know how long you want me to talk about this, because I could talk about it for a while, but
getting a little bit long.
Yeah, the main thing is that there was a major upset yesterday, because OG, which is the team that everyone was like, oh, it's not gonna, this event is not gonna be as fun as the other ones, because OG is gonna take it. It's like not even a question, because they've already, like, Valve rolled out this one major system where they played four big tournaments a year. OG won two of them, and this is the fourth. So everyone's like, okay, this is a done deal. But this team from the Philippines named TNC, who had to make their way through the open qualifiers, like they weren't even directly invited based on performance. They made their way through the open qualifiers. Everyone thought, well, oh, that's nice that they made it that far. That's cool. And then they played in the regional qualifiers, and everyone thought, well, I mean, I wasn't expecting them to get that far. And then they just kept making their way up through the bracket.
Nice.
And at every point, it was like, oh, okay, this is where they'll stop. And so, like, OG was another one of those fights where, because OG lost to another team, and then they got put in the lower bracket. And so they were up against TNC. So everyone was like, okay, well, this is where it was fun while it lasted, but this is where TNC loses. And they like beat them two rounds straight. And it was, nice. It was the craziest match of that entire tournament.
How long is this tournament going on?
All week. It's been going on. It's been going on for the last 2 weeks, and it'll end on Saturday.
A good way to check out Dota 2. I know. I'm sorry to give it short shrift and whatnot. Right.
Yeah, that's fine.
It's cool to watch. Like, I tuned in for a second because I've tuned in a couple times before, but I saw like them in like the drafting ground, like picking their characters, and they have like CNN holograms of the characters. Like, the production value is nuts.
Yeah, they've poured a lot of money into that thing.
And you could watch it in VR, right?
Yeah, there's a whole like spectator client where you're a person in the game, and you can have other people can come in and join your lobby, and you can put on like the faces of different characters in the game and professional players, and it's just like this weird,
Jesus Christ.
Mess. It's not the best way to watch it, but it's like a fun novelty.
Totally.
Especially since, like, once you get anyone trying to like actually watch that game for the first time, it's completely incomprehensible. It's like a bunch of life bars and like different numbers going off everywhere, and like you don't know what's going on, but you see all the life bars go down, and you're like, all right, well, that one team killed the other one.
They did it. Good job.
Good job.
Cool. All right. Do you guys want to move on to answer some community emails?
Sure.
All right. Let's do it. And welcome back to the Game Informer Show. We have some super cool emails from the community that we're going to read off. People send in emails to podcast@gameinformer.com. Notice I say emails and not questions, because sometimes you can send in thoughts, feedback, words of wisdom, crazy
haikus,
tangents, haikus, new features, fan fiction, whatever you want. Send it to podcast@gameinformer.com. We'll choose our favorite from the bunch, and we'll ship them out something real nice, the best thing we can muster. I think this time it is a picture of Suriel eating cereal, eating himself. Let's see. Benjamin from France writes in, the Olympics are in full force, and it brings up an underreported video game story. For the first time since 1988, there will not be an official game for the Summer Olympics, official video game. Any GI memories of the Olympic video games? Is it a foregone conclusion that they'll make their return in 4 years? I had not thought of this.
You know, I think, I don't know the exact parameters of that situation, but I'd imagine, let's say if you're a publisher, you're a developer, you're looking at that license. I don't imagine it's a very fun license to deal with. You know, whether it be the money it costs, or you're talking about every 4 year game.
Yeah.
You know, so I know a lot of people bag on yearly sports games, and that's a different topic. But I think as a developer, being told you're only going to make one every 4 years, I just don't think that as a publisher or developer, that's the kind of situation they like to be in. So I think
it's a tough one to get in the groove for, I guess.
Yeah. And like, you know, where are you going to be in 4 years? What's the technology going to be like? How are you going to budget for, you know, for that? Not to say that games don't take 4 years to make, but I don't think it's an ideal situation. So I wouldn't be surprised if going forward, we just see a totally piecemeal approach. You know, obviously, you know, Sonic and Nintendo.
Yeah, they do it.
With the Mario, they had their thing, you know, for a run, and, you know, that's, you know, come to an end, or they...
No, it's still going on this year. I guess he doesn't count it as an official game.
Yeah, didn't one of those come out this year?
Yeah, for sure. Yep.
Oh, well, there you go. But, I mean, I think, you know, not to bag on that game, but look at the sort of the space, the demographic space that occupies. And if he's talking about, like, a full-fledged, you know, whatever one we used to see back in the, you know, NES or even 2600 days or whatever, I just don't see it, to be honest with you.
Yeah. I had one for the Apple II. That was the Winter Olympics, and I loved it. But it was mainly for, like, the music. Having just, like, a crappy Apple II version of all these countries' national anthems was so awesome. That was my favorite. Did you guys play them growing up at all?
I was big into track and field on NES. Track and field, too.
Oof.
That was the one where crazy tapping,
man.
Right?
I mean, most of them are. And I think one of the big problems with Olympic games is just the ease of control. Like, every time you get to a new event, you're just like, well, what do I got to do?
What do you want from
like,
me?
Seriously, like, okay.
Oh, like caveman games.
Caveman
games. Replayed on replay not that long ago.
Bring it back.
Yeah. Wife tossing.
Yeah. Made JV uncomfortable.
He really did not like the wife tossing segment.
Different times. But
you, you got stuff like one extreme, two extreme, if you want the variety. There's games out there that offer something like that.
But also, you want to make it competitive, right? Like, but how do you make, like, swimming games competitive? Like, how do you set up those lobbies online? And
yeah,
I don't know. It just seems like you'd have to have, like, 12 different lobbies for the 12 different events.
Well, even with, like I said, you're talking about all these different kind of gameplay variations. I mean, if you want to play swimming, or you're doing, let's say, swimming or whatever, you want it to be a great swimming game. You don't want it to be kind of an okay, crappy swimming game, but it's a great javelin game.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
the horse, you know, steeplechase is really where this game excels. I mean, it's, you're going to be all over the board.
It's not built for video games. Yeah.
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 Yeah. Yeah, it's tough.
Unless you do, like, just go completely extreme and just be like, these are all impossible to control, like, and to give you an appreciation of how hard athletes work. Just
take, like,
it,
the goat simulator approach,
yeah, exactly,
to an Olympics
just
game.
Just make it as make the running, like, make the running, like, quap or whatever.
Yeah,
like, just make it as difficult as possible, like, make an art Olympic games.
I did we get a copy of Mario and Sonic?
I don't think so.
I want to see that game. I'm curious. I want to see Wario riding a horse. It's funny. Here we go. Brandon wrote in. I promise I didn't prompt this in any way. I liked Matthew Kato's sports desk Q&A with developers from the Madden team. People don't know, Kato does a column every other week.
Every Monday.
Every Monday,
every
Monday. Talking about sports games and stuff. Everything
that's Tuesday
good
for me. what were we thinking?
I know.
All right, what I found particularly interesting with the Madden Q&A was that the dev response seemed a little combative, if not outright. Then, at least I interpreted the tone as such. Regardless, something I'd not noticed with other Q&As. Could it have to do something with an annualized release schedule of a game is built in the bones of its predecessor, leading to legacy problems they're tired of thinking about or addressing? Or is it the old-fashioned burnout? What was your read on the Madden Q&A?
I know those guys somewhat in the sense that I've, you know, talked to them, you know, multiple times, and I didn't get anything, you know, sort of different or strange or combative from them. You know, I do think that certainly they get a lot of questions, you know, from year to year about, you know, fix this, fix that, or whatever. And those are all legitimate questions. You know, those are great questions. But I think that, you know, maybe not everybody hears some of the rationale that is behind it. So maybe, I think, you know, he's explained it, some of the stories and the rationale they've done, and it's sort of out there. But at the same time, I think it's worth kind of rehashing a lot of different times. But long story longer, I didn't take anything away from that. You know, I know those guys. They love making the game. They're huge football fans, and you know, they're very appreciative of a lot of the community stuff, a lot of the fan input and stuff like that. So it definitely wasn't a brush off, and I wouldn't take anything from that.
What's your read on the Madden community? I'm just reading the YouTube comments where there's a lot of like, make it like the old games, you hacks, and stuff like that. But that's YouTube. But what's your read on your thoughts on Madden 17, and then also, like, is the community feeling optimistic? Is there a prime Madden from a couple years ago they want people to go back to?
I personally think a little bit of that is a red herring, in the sense that I think it's easy to be like, oh, this game, if it would just do what this year, you know, this whatever Madden 10 or whatever did, if it just did what that would do, everything would be fine. I think that's too easy to answer. I don't believe in it. I would say that this year there are specific things that they did for the community, a bunch of them. Some were fixes to gameplay, like aggressive catch. Some were things that people wanted, things like formation subs, which, you know, if you hear that, if you know what that even is, then you know what I'm talking about. That's in the game this year. So they did address community things. That being said, there's certainly always work to be done, and the community always has a lot of things that they want. So I don't know. Like I said, I think they address community things, but there's always something else out there. Yeah.
Totally. It's like Destiny fans. It's like there are a million requests that they can make. So, of course, they will make it, like, naturally. But you're feeling optimistic about 17?
Well, there's things I definitely like about it. I'm still in the process of my review.
Oh, okay.
You know, yeah, I definitely think there's some cool things this year. But we'll have to see, you know, as the review goes on, how it all shakes out.
Is there a peak? I know people always talk about, was it 2K5, right? Mm-hmm. As like the best football game. Do you have a go-to, like your favorite of all time?
I'm, you know, in general, again, this is me personally, I'm not a huge like nostalgia guy. I'm not going to play a game from 10 years ago just because I had a good time with it then. Not to say I don't appreciate those games. So I usually tend to like what's, you know, I've seen in the past couple of years because it's obviously on the new systems. It looks great. It solves certain issues, even though there might be others, you know. So I'm not much of like a hang my hat on one particular
one forever.
Year. Yeah.
That's the most satisfying answer you could have possibly given, Kato. Thank you so much. All right. Chris from Roxbury writes in and says, love the podcast. Keep up the shenanigans. Do voice actors ever break your immersion while playing a game? Sometimes I'm playing a game and I recognize an actor and I think of that person instead of the game character on the screen. For example, when I played Black Ops and met up with Ice Cube's character, all I could think about was Ice Cube the rapper and his various movie roles. When I watched the new Telltale Batman game on YouTube, I immediately heard Troy Baker as Bruce Wayne. I pictured him, of course, as Joel from The Last of Us. It completely breaks my immersion, and I'm wondering if this happens to you guys as well. How often do you guys think about voice actors?
I only do it when they're either really bad or they're, you know, really good.
Yeah.
Because, when it's bad, it's bad. Yeah, insufferable.
Kiefer Sutherland as Snake. That did it for me, where it was like he should have been David Hayter, and then he just has a different voice. And right there, it's just like that disconnect. And then I hear 24, you know, the character from 24. I'm like, okay, that's weird.
Yeah.
And then Mace Windu in Star Wars.
Sam Jackson.
I mean, it was just like, that's Sam Jackson.
Oh, really?
You know, yeah. Like, so that one, it was just kind of, I don't know. I always like it when they find new talent for stuff like that, kind of like they did with Daisy Ridley and John Boyega. But yeah, it can be difficult when you see these well-known people get slid into these roles where you're trying to picture them as something else and it just doesn't work.
Or now just, I mean, the Troy Baker, Nolan North dynasty, where it's like, I think about it all the time when I hear them in a game. It's just like, oh, how does this compare to their earlier roles? Like, The Last of Us, as brilliant as that game is, Nolan North's performance in that game drove me insane because all I could hear was like Trey Parker as his weird David character. He's like, hey, come over here. It just sounded like such a South Park character. I cannot get it out of my head. Also, I want to point out on the topic of terrible voice acting, people didn't talk about Ratchet & Clank 2016, which you reviewed, Reiner. There's a character named Cora in that game. It is some of the worst voice acting I've heard from a AAA game in like a decade. It is abysmal, and I tried to save the clips on my PS4 and I messed it up, but if anybody else has played that game, please save those clips. It is abysmal. All right, you
ever play Pokken?
Yeah,
that had terrible voice acting
and there was a lot of it. Yeah, there just like so menu much narration and yeah, stuff.
The main character, the main lady who follows you around that game, awful.
Just like, sounds her bored.
I don't know if it was like really bad directing or whatever, but like that was some really bad voice acting.
Really bad. Tyler from Nashville writes in and says, Telltale has teased they're working on a Marvel project, but nothing's known about it. If you could choose a superhero or a team of heroes for Telltale to base your next game around, what would it be? For me, I'd love to see an X-Men game where you play as a new member of Xavier's school. What do you guys think about Telltale Marvel after Batman? Are you less optimistic about it, Reiner?
No, it's just no comment.
Oh, Reiner's playing like he knows something. There's a microphone in front of you. Say a word into it.
What Marvel comic? I don't know.
I'm guessing, I mean, there's the Grand Conspiracy, which is fun to read about how Marvel doesn't want to promote X-Men because Fox owns the movie rights. So they don't want to bolster that IP. But I think X-Men would be a really good choice for
X-Men
Telltale.
Would be really good, yeah.
What's better than that, Suriel?
I don't know. Maybe reaching outside like traditional superhero stuff. I'd love to see like Telltale take a crack at like Venture Brothers.
Oh, okay.
Which is
or Archer?
Yeah, something like that. Like something that riffs on that kind of stuff. Like very classic cartoons or the ensemble setup.
Yeah.
I think that would be pretty cool because we definitely don't see enough episodes of Venture Brothers on like a yearly basis.
Yeah, Jeff Cork and I are still beating the drum for a Twilight Zone game from Telltale.
That'd be sweet.
Cool. Yeah, that'd be
every
cool.
Episode be a different thing.
Totally. Yeah. No more consequences carrying over. Just make the consequences huge and self-contained, and each one moving forward.
Be incredible.
But. For the Marvel thing, they're probably just going to do Iron Man or Spider-Man or something boring.
Avengers,
I would hope they just do Squirrel Girl. Like, I hope they conquer something new, you know, that Marvel isn't touching.
Just do Squirrel Girl.
Why is it so hard? Just do it right.
Throw millions at that.
Or, you know, I'll channel Jeff Cork and say, put MODOK in his own
Throw
Telltale game.
MODOK.
Yeah. Let's see. Brett Williams from Martinsville, Indiana writes in and says, I've been watching through some super replays lately and I've noticed that several of you are not shy about using bad language. Reiner, what's up with that? What is
it's an adult show.
Is it? Mm-hmm. What is your favorite swear word to say when you are playing games, especially out of frustration? Obviously, since the podcast is edited, you can abbreviate the words phrase. Anyways, I love the show. Thank you.
Off.
All right.
That's yours.
Scott, let me shut that down. So like when you're reviewing a game or playing it at home, you'll just scream that during Abzu is constantly F off.
No, fuck off.
Oh, I see. I see. Wow. It's good. You guys have go-to?
Yeah, damn it.
Ooh, edgy.
I mean, it's
not even
like,
need to bleep that, right? Come on. It's got to be good.
It's like got a grunt, though. Like, damn it.
Surreal?
It's probably something like fuck off or something. Recently, I heard it. I read a tweet, and I've just been starting to use it like kind of ironically, but it's become a habit where I'll just randomly say, oh, Christ on the cross.
That's good.
Wow.
It was supposed to be it was a dumb joke tweet, wow. But I've suddenly started saying it like kind of like pretending to be like some old lady or something, like playing a game and just being a Christ on the cross.
I also do son of a, but I put so much rage into son of a that I have nothing left and I end it. I've never hit the last word.
Wow.
I don't know what it is.
It's still legendary what it could possibly be. This is a dumb one, but YTMND is super important to me, that old joke website. I made so many of them, and there was this meme, which is so stupid, but it's about a horse's phallus, and it would just insert saying that at random times and whatnot. It always made me laugh, and so that is carried forward to this day. If I'm playing a game, multiplayer game, and I lose, I'll just shout out, horse f-! Like, it's just a reflex of mine that I'll never get rid of. It'll probably be my final words, I think. All right,
good.
Tyler O writes in and says, hey, guys, and oh, wait, no, this is not Tyler. This is Pat, I'm sorry, from Ireland. Hey, guys and gals, I recently started watching the Netflix show Stranger Things. I started watching it after seeing lots of good things about it in the Overblood Facebook group. Amidst all the positivity was the revelation of the character Jonathan's likeness to one J.V. Gwaltney. I feel that if I had watched the show prior to having this pointed out, I might not have noticed, but now I simply cannot unsee it. It's gotten to the point of outright distraction where I'm pretty much shouting at the screen saying, damn it, JV, stop taking photographs. Hope this finds you well. I had 4 different emails all about how much JV Gwaltney looks like this Stranger Things character.
Yeah.
I need to start watching Stranger Things now just to understand.
It is one
of
the...
He got a haircut, but it's not helping.
It's not helping.
It is one of the best shows on... I guess you don't say TV. It's
in
one
the
of the
computer.
Best shows out there. You
okay.
Can watch.
And then this person writes in and says, Pat from Ireland, PS Game Club question suggestion. How about for any future game club, you guys come up with some kind of humiliating forfeit for anybody that quits a game early, like making them wear dumb crap during a future podcast filming or compile an awful super replay feature featuring anybody who's quit the game club. I'm with you. Those people need to be tarred and feathered.
Yeah.
I think
who quit?
Kato might have during Uncharted 4. But...
Oh, well, that was... There's a little work context. I had a lot of stuff.
That's true. You know, that's true.
If you like all the great content that we put out here at Game Informer on the magazine and the website.
Sports Desk.
Then, you know, you would understand. I think we're also on the eve of E3, if I'm not mistaken.
That could be. And that one didn't bother me because we had so many people on Uncharted 4. The one that bothered me was Deus Ex, the one coming up. Because
yeah, let's
Joe
talk about those Deus Ex bastards. Okay?
Joe Juba and Jeff Cork bailed, and it hurt.
They're the worst.
Anyways,
those guys.
Tyler O finally writes in and says, with Destiny's reveal this week or last week, it got me wondering, how do you guys settle on a cover story? Do you guys go based on popularity and what is hot at the moment? Because we seem to get the annual Call of Duty and Assassin's Creed as cover stories. Do you guys try and find and get the focus towards smaller titles sometimes? How does it work? Reiner, you've been around a long time.
Yeah, I mean, I've been involved in every decision since I started in 95, I think. So, It all depends on what you have and what you discover. I mean, obviously, unlike Hollywood, which as soon as a new film is signed, they announce it, right? It's just like, we're making this and here's who's attached to it. Games, they try to keep them all secrets. So there's a lot of digging around, figuring out what's out there, contacting companies, trying to figure out what's available. And then once you have that kind of pool, you kind of start looking at your options, which weighing them to having these big discussions, which involves everybody on staff, by the way. Andy and I and Bert's don't just make decisions on our own. It's very much like we weigh everybody's feedback and discuss them. And that's usually what it comes down to, is a lot of it is our interest in these games and what we think would make really great stories or things that readers should have in front of them as a game on the cover. Like, this is one of the 12 games that we're recommending as something you should read this year.
Yeah, I think it's covered the gamut of a lot of... different kinds of games out there. I mean, I certainly this person's talking about, you know, Call of Duty reoccurring or Assassin's Creed or whatever. But I mean, I don't remember the exact, you know, situation, but there's been times when there's been smaller games we've been put on and we just like it because we're like, you know what? This is a good story. This is a good story to tell by this developer. And maybe that year or that particular month, there was something else that we could have done. I'm sure people would have liked equally, but I think, you know,
like, Tacoma, we put that on our cover, and that's by the guys that made No Man's Sky, or Gone Home.
Yeah.
And
well, they also put No Man's Sky on.
It's on my brain. But they made Gone Home, and we're like, that's one of the most influential indie games ever, you know, at this kind of new age. And it's like, yeah, we should tell their story of what they're doing next. Like,
yeah,
are they sizing up? You know, what's going on there? So we put that on the cover. That is very much not your typical big AAA game, but we thought that was an interesting story to tell.
And yeah, and even as a reader, I remember seeing that cover. It's like, wow, they don't do that. They don't do that enough. Like, they should. That was a really cool cover story to read something about, something you don't necessarily see all the time.
Yeah. Here in the Assassin's Creed front, I've gotten a lot of those trips. To be fair, over the last 6 years, we've only done 2 Call of Duty cover stories. I realize it's not that often, but I think people would be surprised if they saw the full process, how much of it comes down to boring scheduling. I'm like, all right, we kind of have one option that's looking good for this month, but that one seems to be falling through. The developers aren't going to quite be ready to show anything at this point. It's just like nitty gritty scheduling dates type of thing.
Yeah, well, to your point about Hollywood, you know, it'd be great if you could just put it in cement and then there you go. But I mean, the amount of time I see you guys working, you know, on the phones and all this sort of stuff to like secure a cover, and then maybe something changes and it's like, oh, this, you know, opportunity comes up that, you know, you just can't pass up. Yeah. I mean, it's work down to the wire.
Yeah, there's been games that we've had kind of in limbo for like 8 months that just keep floating because of development schedules and stuff like that, and when the team's ready. And for people out there, like, a lot of times I'll see people like, why didn't you put Mass Effect on the cover? Why didn't you put the new Grand Theft Auto? It's like, we're not making those games or like dictating when they get announced. I mean, it's very much when the dev team is ready, when the game is at a point where it's ready to be shown. And that has changed so much over the years. These games are longer dev cycles, takes time, and the amount of polish they put on them right up to the end makes doing these kind of first looks tricky.
For sure. As you learn with No Man's Sky, things are always shifting in development too. Exactly. You know, it's all over the place. Will from California, Palo Alto, writes in and says, hey, GI crew, here's a question for you guys. Whatever happened to arcade-style games? Gone are the days of sports games like NBA Street and NFL Blitz. Now it's all about ultra-realism and how detailed the sweat looks on a player's forehead. What is the future of arcade-type games? Will I ever see another Burnout, or am I stuck with Forza? Why don't more developers make games that are easy to pick up and play? Thank you, and keep up the great work.
I don't know. I think that, you know, these days with your, you know, Rocket Leagues and, you know, smaller projects, I think there's plenty of opportunity to do that. I think, and, you know, no offense to our reader, but I bet you if they went on Steam and, you know, looked around a bit, you know, I think they'd find plenty of arcade gameplay, as they're calling it, style games.
Yeah, it's moving out of the AAA space, it seems like. Indies have really picked up that mantle of the NBA Street or the NBA Jam, you know.
And the license is so expensive for developers. It's become ridiculous. That's changed over like the last 10, 20 years, getting the NFL license. They might sign exclusive deals with EA or MLB and Sony. MLB, like, there's only one trading card now for baseball cards. It's only Topps. I mean, it's just a whole different market now with this license and how they handle it. So that's a big determining factor of how many games you see in the marketplace.
Yeah.
I think for me, I think a lot of it, like you said, has shifted towards indies. And I think the thing that maybe the reader is missing is that, like, they're not seeing as much, like, straight-up sports stuff involved in those arcade-type games. Because I think when you go to the indie stuff, you go to something like Video Ball, and that's, like, completely abstracted.
Yeah.
Because they don't have to make it sports-like. But I think something like, here are people playing a sport, like, and it is very simple to play. I think that's the kind of thing that you don't get as much of as you used to. But as far as like here are some interesting games like that, I think there's a ton of stuff.
Just, I wish they bring back NBA Street. I could go for a new one of those.
Yeah, but
I love that series so
much. You do that without the license or the players, the player association, you're at a loss already.
Do you need a license for an alien and Bigfoot, though? Those
Big,
SSX
Bigfoot,
characters.
Bigfoot's real, so maybe.
That's true. People never talk about it.
First, though.
That's right.
People never talk about Bigfoot.
No, people never talk about it. In 2009, I think it was, they made this, EA made a digital download game, digital downloadable game, that was called Madden Arcade. Do you remember that?
No.
I mean, there was like NFL Street.
No, there was a game called Madden Arcade, where they're trying to like channel a little bit of like the Blitz sentimentality, I guess, through there, but it seemed fine. I bought it because I like, you know, the old football games quite a bit, and it kind of captured that magic.
That sounds like NFL Extreme, which had Minnesota Viking John Randall on the cover. That was the game day equivalent of kind of like an NFL Blitz.
Game Day, right? Used to be like the Sony 99.
Oh, no, I know Game Day. Yeah, I love Game Day.
There was NFL Extreme. Whereas,
you love Game Day? Let's back this up. You love Game Day?
I love NFL Game Day 98. That is my game.
So this was like that. This was like 2000, I think, they released NFL Extreme.
Wow, was it good?
You'll have to check it out. We could do it on replay.
Was it like John Randall playing in the streets?
I remember
there was like
the
grenades.
Game,
I think you could get
it.
Grenades or something.
That sounds like a great replay. I'll have to check that out. Let's see. We got Jacob Shoemaker, not Shoemaker, from Missouri. Florissant, Missouri. He says, I'd like to ask, when you play a Pokemon game, do you give nicknames to some or all of your Pokemon or none of your Pokemon? P.S. Thanks for all the great content and the shout outs to the Overblood Facebook group.
No, my Pokemon are tools. I'm just
kidding. Giovanni.
No, I don't. I just don't. I never, like, I think if I had a bunch of nicknames for all my Pokemon, I just come up with the dumbest things, and it's just generation after generation, it gets a little harder to make up stupid nicknames.
That's true. That's true.
So it's all just capital letters. What are the names of Pokemon?
I tend to keep it pretty basic, too, especially for, like, new generations, because I want to learn the names of these things.
Yeah.
So if I'm replaying an older game, then I'll rename it. But it got me thinking, do you guys know about the Nuzlocke style of playing Pokemon games? Mm-mm. The Nuzlocke Challenge? So it's this game that developed from this one guy in a certain way he played and whatnot. I don't know if he was streaming it or just posting in blogs, but it became this format of playing Pokemon games where when you enter an area, you're only allowed to keep the first Pokemon that you capture in that area. That rule seems boring. I don't really get the advantage of that. But the fun twist is that if you play Nuzlocke style, if a Pokemon faints, they're out forever. It's permadeath Pokemon. And because the Pokemon games after X and Y with experience share have gotten so easy, I feel like I want to do it for Sun and Moon, try the Nuzlocke way, and just make it this weird XCOM permadeath version of Pokemon.
That's cool. I like that.
You want to play it with me? That's style, Reiner?
Permadeath Pokemon?
Yeah, heck yeah.
But especially since like all the areas are tiered in terms of levels. Like it definitely seems doable.
That sounds cool.
But it'll be devastating when you lose your main.
Yeah.
I named my main to answer the question.
Oh,
and it was an embarrassing moment when we dug up red or blue here. And it's like, I think it was blue because it was Squirtle. And immediately the Squirtle appeared on screen and its name was Anakin. And I was like, oh boy, this is going to go over bad. And everybody just started laying into me.
It's perfect.
But yeah, so I name my main ones usually like Anakin or something after Star Wars.
Mace Windu.
It might be the new one.
Let's see. Tyler from Philly writes in. Sorry, I should have given you guys a heads up on this one, but we're coming in hot. So think on the top of your head. I'd love to know if you have any favorite subheads for reviews. You know, the little phrase under the game's title on your site, done by either yourself or another editor. My all-time favorite is Jeff Cork's Firewatch review, Gabbin in the Woods.
That's pretty good.
My favorite is also a Jeff Cork one for Animal Crossing Happy Home Designer, where he called it low in fun housing.
That, man.
It's a stretch, but I really enjoyed it.
Back when I did freelance, it was earlier this year, when I reviewed Super Hot, the tagline for that one was halt and press fire. And that was most proud I've ever been of a subhead.
All right. That's not bad. That's not bad. Is it always a pun? What philosophy do you guys have for subheads?
No, I usually hate puns, so I try to stay away. I think it's too easy.
Too high for a good pun.
Well, it seems like the go-to for most headlines, right? Like, is to try to play some kind of pun. So I try to do something that's more meaningful, that speaks to the game or the game language.
All right. How highfalutin are you, Kato?
I'd agree. I'm not a huge pun guy. I would say my crutch is alliteration. That's just behind the scenes. I mean, that's one. If you see that, then you've probably, readers, I've maybe either struck on something I really like or I'm just being lazy. God, you know, I don't know. I know there's been a ton of good ones. I want to just say, just as a general comment, I'm sure Matt Helgeson, former co-editor here, host, I'm sure he has some really good subheads if anyone wants to look those up.
Oh, boy.
Because I'm sure there's just some salty, just...
Oh, yeah.
Just bitter.
We used to do a headline competition. You remember this.
Yeah.
There used to be this trophy in the office, and it would be at the end of the issue when we'd get the magazine, we'd do headline of the month voting. But it got to a point where people were going so ridiculous in the headlines that it was just like...
It was getting personal. I mean,
yeah.
Justin Leeper, I'm sure I probably he may have, I'm just going to guess he probably shed at least one tear over not winning
like
that.
If I grabbed one of those in the middle there.
Pointing at magazines on the set for the listeners.
It's just filled with awful stuff.
Don't go back.
Go back. But it got to a point where like, we got to stop this because it's affecting, like, we're putting too much effort and this is getting too personal.
And it's not producing any good results.
Yeah. Speaking of going back, Whitman Johnson from Chicago writes in and says, "Hey, all you cool cats. So it occurred to me that Game Informer as a magazine turned 25 years old this year."
We will soon.
We will. What is GI doing to celebrate its 25th?
That's a secret.
Question. They hired me.
It's coming. It's coming up this fall, so it's still.
We still got time, so stay tuned.
We'll make a thing of it.
Yeah, stay tuned.
I think there's a couple ideas floating around right now, but I don't know if anything is locked in and nailed on the wall like the 95 thesis. Or
Half-Life 3.
That's right. Yeah, we're just gonna put it on the cover with no info.
I mean, we've been saving it, the announcement, till this date. Like Valve's been wanting to release it for 15 years, and they're like, "Come on!" We're like, "We're saving this for 25."
Right.
And then, you know, like Grand Theft Auto 6, man, it's 50 years.
Fans love this kind of stuff, Reiner. Keep it going. Amar writes in, quick question. Dearest Game Informer crew, I'm a longtime listener back when Matt Helgeson started the podcast. First time emailer. Who amongst the crew is going to Gamescom this year? Would you mind meeting a big fan in Cologne or at a conference center? By the way, I'm a nice guy and not a creep.
See, you can't do that. You can't do that. You can't say that.
It's like a nickname. You can't give yourself a nickname.
And this guy's nickname is clearly Creep. Amar, I believe Gamescom is next week, and it's Mike Futter and Elise Favis going. Mm-hmm. And so feel free to say hello to them if you see them walking by. I ran it by Elise to make sure it's cool, but
yeah,
don't worry, Elise, talking to people.
Not a creep.
Yeah, Amar.
It says
the opposite of a creep. So look for the least creepy guy.
Yell from across the hall and then get a running start with your hands waving in the air.
This is the way to do it, Amar.
Just yell, "Are you a creep?" into the crowd.
Yeah, just
not whoever
a creep.
Says no,
not a creep.
Then hug him and say, "Thanks for listening to Matt Helgeson's podcast." Awesome. We hope to cover Gamescom next week on the podcast. I don't know, maybe we'll Skype somebody in or just talk about it in a recap type of thing, but it should be a decent week for games news. Should be fun. What's your favorite email of the bunch? What stands out for you guys?
Swear words is fun.
That's true. Mm-hmm. I like the Olympics one, but the guy's from France and we can't ship overseas. So I'm sorry, Benjamin. But real great. It's from Marseille. Ben Reeves and I were just there. Let's see. We have the...
I like the subhead one.
I do too.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, I'm a fan of
it. There we go. Good. Tyler from Philly.
Cover story one was good too.
Yep. Yeah. Thank you so much for those emails. I like the arcade one too from Will.
All good.
Honestly, hundreds of great emails in that inbox. So thank you so much for keeping those coming. I'm sorry that I don't have time for all of them. Maybe we'll have like a super community feedback show where we just read those off.
Super replay feedback edition.
Let's do it. Let's get through that inbox. All right. Thanks everybody for writing in. We appreciate it. And Tyler will ship you out something real nice. And now people can stay tuned and hear Ben Reeves, Wade Wojcik, and I talk all about the ending and final third of Deus Ex.
There's only three of you left. It's like Survivor.
I know, Reiner. It's a real point of contention. But it's a really fun talk. So stay tuned for that. And welcome back to Game Informer's Game Club. Hey, I'm still here. We got Wade Wojcik, champion of the people. What a hero. God among men. And Ben Reeves, who will do?
I am. Yeah, I'm just here.
Will do.
And Cork and Joe are back.
No, they
aren't. In their office.
They didn't make it. We've already addressed how disappointed we are several times. And trust me, I feel you, community. I totally get it. It is a big point of contention. But we're here. We're going to finish off talking about Deus Ex Human Revolution.
Mm-hmm.
We all beat the game.
Yes.
So this is going to be a little bit about the ending specifically, the last third, and thoughts on the overall game. We get a lot of great emails from the community that they sent in to podcastgameinformer.com. We're going to read all those.
Mm-hmm.
What do you guys want to do? How do you want to structure this? Do you want to read some basic feedback on stuff we've said already first, or do you want to... How about feedback first?
It's a good way to get a roll.
Share thoughts. All right.
Yeah.
So this is Jake Reynolds. He writes in and says, hey, my name is Jake. I really like part two of the Game Club discussion for Deus Ex. I really don't mind constructive criticism of a game, but the last discussion was very negative. And Joe is so stupid. No, much more interesting it's and productive true, discussion this time. I completely agree that unlocking the Praxis system completely changes the dynamic of the game. Certain routes now become open to you, and advancing through the levels becomes way more fun. The mix of sneaking, strategy, and using violence as a last resort makes this game more very enjoyable. Plus, I love the cutscenes. In my opinion, it provides a drive of the story very similar to Metal Gear Solid. This is no Metal Gear Solid, in my opinion. And then he says, thanks, guys. New to the podcast, and you guys are by far my favorite. Thank you so much. Yeah, I felt good about that positive discussion. It seems like when we're begging people to join us on a game club, having a positive discussion about a game is great. But
you didn't have to beg me. I think it's nice to have maybe one person who's maybe the, you know, just to give a balanced discussion.
Yeah.
Say even like Uncharted, we were pretty praiseworthy of that game. But if one person had been on and been like, I hate this game in a lot of ways,
right,
that would have been interesting.
And there were people that wrote in. I feel like they can help fill that gap too, right, if we're all on the same page. But there's
can't
varying
for
degrees
that
there. So Isaiah James says, hi guys, glad to hear you're enjoying the game more. I played it for the first time last winter, and it quickly became one of my favorite games ever. In that press conference situation you guys talked about, I burst through the doors and talked him down on camera, and that whole situation was solved.
They probably had the pheromone unlocked.
So many pheromones. Yoo-hoo! Nathan Keeling, who's written in a lot, we appreciate it. He writes in and says, I'm a huge fan of Deus Ex original, and after hearing the part two discussion, I need to give a major spoiler for the first two games.
Whoa.
So anyone who has not played them, please plug your ears for a few minutes.
All right.
Wade, do you really not want to know? Really? It doesn't seem that major.
No, it's fine. It's fine.
All right. Eliza, who's the news anchor, is one of several prototypes the Illuminati used to create Icarus Helios, the god AI that hounds Denton, eventually merging, possessing him, and ultimately taking over the world in Deus Ex 2. Skeptical? Remember that weird hand statue with a hologram of the world in it at Eliza's building? It's the first thing you see at the start of Deus Ex 1. So she plays a larger role in the future than we all realize.
Yeah.
Well, she'll come back up again in this discussion, I think.
I think so. Colin Perkins from St. Paul, Minnesota, greatest place on earth, writes in and says, I've always heard good things about the Deus Ex franchise, so I finally decided to tackle the series in preparation for Mankind Divided. I started with the original Deus Ex in January and wrapped up the fall in June.
Wow.
Do you guys know about the fall? We haven't talked about it once.
No, we haven't.
It's that iOS...
Oh, the iOS
one that they ported to Steam. It's apparently not great, but I'm really curious if anyone out there has played it. It's almost too late to send feedback in, but go ahead and send it in. I'll read it on the podcast anyway. We'll talk about this game forever, and then we'll talk about Mankind Divided forever. Anyways, now that I'm all caught up, by the way, it's crazy timing that he decided to do this, and then he chose to do this as a game.
Yeah, meant to be.
He says, now that I'm all caught up, I wanted to share my favorite quirk Easter egg in the series. The fact that you can shoot hoops in every game. I didn't know this.
Really? In this one too?
Apparently. I discovered the basketball court in Hell's Kitchen during the original game and thought the developers put in a silly distraction in what otherwise was a very serious game. Then another court showed up early in Invisible War. By the time I started Human Revolution, I was actively looking for a court in hopes that the inside joke didn't get lost in the franchise reboot. Eidos, Montreal didn't disappoint. Each time I come across a court, I spend 5 or 10 minutes fruitlessly trying to make a three-pointer.
Huh.
Sure, I've yet to make a basket, but it's little touches like these that make me dig the franchise so much. Looking forward to tossing up more bricks in a few weeks with Mankind Divided. Awesome. I didn't know.
That's interesting.
I didn't.
Is that in Detroit? Know.
Like, you would think so. I'm trying to think. Singapore, probably they into
China.
Basketball?
Yeah.
They're really into it. Yeah.
What do you mean? Tao Ming. They love basketball over there, right?
They love that guy because he's Chinese.
Right. Do you know that basketball's not a thing in China?
No, I have no idea.
That's cool. I can't believe we all missed the basketball court, though.
Yeah, I don't even remember seeing one.
Maybe I'm just so used to it in Overwatch.
I'm so blind to sports that I just walk right by him.
All right, before we get into specific stuff here, part three, where are you guys at? I know you're playing this again, but how's your temperature? What's the needle? What direction is the needle going?
So this one had the DLC, the Missing Link.
Did it stand out to you this time?
It did, because it's a chapter that, you could take out and nothing really changes, but it fleshes out a lot.
Yeah.
Like when it ends, you still wake up in the cryo tube that you went in.
Right? Mm-hmm.
It makes the last third of our game club feel a lot longer. At least at least it did to me.
I think so. That was a bit of a grind. Reeves, where are you at?
It is funny because at the end of the last podcast, we were talking. You're like, I haven't played that yet. And it just struck me as funny because like when you actually play it, knowing it's there, it seems so obvious that's like the DLC.
But the first time I went through, I was just like, this is the game.
Right.
What a weird little reset here in the middle of everything. Yeah, I'm with you. It made it feel longer. That really lowered my enjoyment. I wish that I could have removed that chunk because it brought me back to the beginning of the game, yeah, which I hated so much, where they remove all your mm-hmm. abilities, all the augments. It resets your guns in a weird way. So it's just like, okay. And then they give you praxis points. And it's like, do I spend these? Are they going to be reset? Am I getting my stuff back?
Yeah.
I just hate that feeling of building up and then they Metroid you, but in this kind of gray area kind of way.
It was the worst way to do that. I don't, if they were going to integrate them, why not, I don't know, somehow balance it so you can keep your stuff?
Because they wanted it to be standalone so you could jump back in. So that's why they had to Metroid you and remove all your abilities like that.
Yeah,
so it's a tough thing structurally.
Sucks.
What happened?
Gameplay-wise?
Okay, so let's see. We got somebody that wrote in about it saying, I would love to know how much, how the missing link plays for people playing the director's cut. This is Barbara Drew that wrote in. I'm playing the DLC with the original game. You access it from the main, from an option in the main menu. It's not part of the main game at all. And I played it after completing the main mission, so the transition was a little weird. Suddenly I'm back to where I was several hours ago. It seems like a weird design decision. Mm-hmm. Also, losing all my praxis points and augments really stank. Being depowered in games is something that I really hate. I don't care if it makes sense from within the narrative. Having lost all my hard work sucks.
Yeah, well, I mean, it could have been done better. Like, I was fine with losing them right away, but I wanted to get them all back before the boss battle, at least. But you get it back at the very end. You get everything back.
That's what was confusing, because I was saving all those praxis points because, like, I don't know if I want to use these on the abilities I already had, because I don't know if it'll then carry over. So I don't know if I should waste it. So I was just inching along, and then with that boss fight and that maniac guy with the magnum sitting up in that little room upstairs, I was like, well, I think I should just try and take this guy out and end the boss fight as quickly as possible here. And so I used all my praxis points, got up to level 5 hacking, hacked through that door, just went all in on hacking, just immediately knocked him out. It was very satisfying. Shot him in the head, took his magnum, and then waited for like the fade to black to the cutscene. And it defied the rules of video games.
Right.
The boss fight kept going on. You take out all his minions too. That's not the way games should
and
work.
And the robot.
Yes, exactly. And then I had so little ammo.
Oh my gosh.
I didn't know what to do. So it's like, there's guys like on the catwalks. Mm-hmm. It's like, well, I don't have a sniper rifle. I guess I'll just fire at them and hope I can kill them from this distance. But it was a rough fight for me.
Yeah.
That's not the way you should use those praxis points.
No kidding. And then I got all my praxis points back at the end, and it didn't reset things. Because I was reading around online trying to figure out what I should do, and it seemed to imply that you could kind of reset. But nope, I guess I'm sticking with like that hardcore hacking strategy. And it's like, okay, I guess I have to reinvest in everything else.
See, well, you get your praxis points back, though.
You do, yeah. But I just
wish
your
tree isn't reset.
Exactly. I was hoping the tree would get fully reset.
And
I
guess the ones you spent during
during the
that makes sense. Like, I got 60 praxis points when I finished, so I just like maxed out all the augs. So
nice.
I didn't have to worry about that. But that does suck. Like, if you don't have enough to finish every tree, then you're just stuck with what you decided during this.
During that weird little one off.
Right.
Yeah. And it's funny, now that I think about it, I totally got the Icarus landing system at that moment. And now that I finished the game, I did not use it once.
Really?
I feel like that's a great aug to have early on in the game.
Yeah.
But towards the end, I never jumped off a platform.
That's a
and
great
never
point.
Used it at all.
Well, in the one part of the facility where there's that tower in the middle, like, you know, with the,
which
with
facility?
The prisoners on the outside.
This is the DLC? or Singapore?
No, yeah, this is God, what?
The DLC is the one with the prisoners.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
So during that part, you know, you got the tower in the middle with the monitors you can hack.
Yeah.
I jumped off that a lot.
Okay.
So, well.
What did you guys do for the DLC for saving the prisoners or the whistleblower?
Reeves, what'd you do?
I saved the prisoners because, I don't know, I was like, well, there's more lives. And I was, for some reason, I assumed like, well, there'll be some other way later on to like take this guy down. But it's also like DLC, so it's kind of like, you don't know the story and how it continues outside of that.
Right. So it can't really have too many consequences.
And, yeah, exactly. So unless they pick it up in Mankind Divided, I don't know that they will.
So you guys went on the cover story trip, and we're going to get into this later, but just on a base level, do they carry over the saves at all?
Not really, no. And in fact, well, we can talk about once we get to the ending part.
Yeah.
But basically what they said is, no matter what you chose for an ending, it still kind of results in the same thing for the sequel.
Yeah, they try to leave things a little ambiguous about what Jensen actually chose. But, I mean, it's pretty clear that on some level, these things are going to happen no matter what. Right. So they leave things ambiguous. So it's like, well, your ending that you chose could have still fit into this narrative.
Okay.
But they're not, it's not Mass Effect style where things are going to pick up exactly.
And it's on so many systems. I understand that'd be a tough thing to do. But Wade, you're so excited about it. Do you want to talk about where we start out this time around?
Well, just real quick.
Yeah.
The prisoner versus whistleblower
thing.
Oh,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
I saved both.
Oh, la-di-da. How'd you do that?
Well, my first playthrough, I saved the whistleblower, and I was like, yeah, that's sad, though, because I had to watch everyone choke to death.
Jesus. With the exact same mirrored animations in both monitors. Yeah.
Let me out. You promised to save me. Which includes the one girl you talk to that's down in the cell when you walk by her.
Oh.
She gets transferred up there.
Oh, really?
I just walked right by her. I would not have it.
But there is a secret vent you go through, and then you have to like smash through a wall or something, and you get to the source of the poison, and then you can just break it. And then the Russian voice is like, "Good job, Ratan! Like you found the secret thing. You were able to save them both."
So the guy at the end, I forget his name, Quinn,
yeah.
Who's the secret like leader,
Russian Irish dude.
Yeah, exactly. He seemed kind of annoyed with me that I had let the whistleblower die.
Well, he's like, that was a loss to humanity overall.
Did you do the same thing?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, he was like, bad call, man. So he's probably pretty happy with
you.
Yeah,
he was like, oh, cool, you did it.
Come
good job.
Pat on the back.
Come in for a smooch.
Yeah.
Well, congratulations. Did you look up like the fact or the walkthrough to figure that out?
Well, I did when I first beat the game because I was really curious if there was a way. So that just was in the back of my head from last time. But it's really hard to find. Like, you have to almost know. Like where it is.
Before we leave the DLC stuff, there's a couple weird moments. I guess a lot of this game, I was confused about the plot. And I understand this because I was not reading a lot of emails during a lot of side quests. Why did Jensen just crawl into a crate? Like, goodbye, cruel world. I'm going in here for a while.
Oh, so he was trying to find the scientists.
So he's just trying to be like carried away.
So what happened was, so when you get back to Singapore, you meet up with that like crime lord boss dude who's the bartender at the Hive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And he was like, all right.
Well, that's not Singapore. That's China.
Sorry. Okay. Shanghai. So he's like, there's this boat leaving. You have to rescue his son. And then he's like, all right, fine. There's this boat leaving that will take you to your scientists. And so you're just like stowing away aboard the ship to get to where the scientists are.
Gotcha.
So he just knew that boat was going to where the scientists were.
Something like that. Yeah.
And okay. After that bomb goes off.
In my memory of it, it was like he wakes up in Panchia or whatever. But that's actually later.
No. You take the rocket.
Right, later. Yeah. So where are you when you find the scientists? That's just some
Singapore.
Base. That's in Singapore?
Yeah.
Okay.
Wait, the scientists aren't Singapore? Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. Okay, that's right. Yeah, we have to track down the three of them. And I want to get to that in a bit. But that opening confused me. Where it's just Jensen being like, I'm going off the grid for a while.
Yeah.
And he wakes up getting punched in the face. Like, what the hell is
happening? I guess they just found him.
Because,
hiding.
In the normal game, it just cuts from cryopod to cryopod.
Yeah, where he wakes up in Singapore.
Right.
And I wonder if they did that intentionally because they're like, we need to leave a space for us to add DLC later. They must have done that intentionally.
I think so.
Designing the game.
Yeah, must have. Also, the part that made me laugh in that DLC is, God, I think it is Quinn. Just the guy who's like, hey, you got that scanning retinal eyeball? Here, I normally sell guns, but let me install a new eyeball for you, Jensen. And then just fades to black, fades back up, and Jensen's like, wow, what an eyeball. It's like, what? You just let this random dude gouge out your eye? Like, this is the future we have?
No. You didn't, like, he found an eye.
Right, I know, to, like, get in the retinal scanner and whatnot. But it's just, like, this weird abbreviated scene.
Oh,
it was like, well, new eyeball, here we go.
And that was only to get through that door or whatever.
Right. Yeah.
But, like, what if you had never found that eye?
Well, I think that was a main quest. I think you had to find the eye.
Yeah. I thought I randomly picked it up.
Oh, really? Just loot from someone's body?
Yeah, that's what I thought I'd remembered, but...
Did you guys drag bodies around a lot in this game?
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Well, just in this part, because I lost all the practice points, so I had to hide more bodies.
Mm.
So in the opening, when you get out of the chair and you're trying to sneak around the first guys guarding you, I would, like, one by one, like, knock them out and then drag their bodies down into a vent. So at the end, I had, like, five guys all crammed into this tiny little, like, duct.
Oh, wow.
That's funny.
I just went on a slaughter spree. Normally, I try and be stealthy, and I think I did a pretty good job of it overall in this game. When in this DLC, I was like, well, you're resetting me. I'm going back to the beginning of the game. F you. Let's bring out a shotgun and tear this hallway up.
Where's an old lady I can shoot in the face?
Yeah. That's why I was so out of ammo during that boss fight and just completely hosed. And then once it got to Singapore, then it was like, here's all the ammo you could possibly imagine. Like, where were you guys during the DLC? Yeah. It was like Last of Us out there.
I can't even hold all this ammo. I was constantly in my inventory, like, even though I had it maxed out. After I got all my stuff, I was like, I don't need all this stuff. So I got to the end boss of the whole game, and I'm like, there's no way I can use any of all the stuff I've collected.
Right. Oh, yeah.
And yet every time I find like some shotgun shells or something that I really want, I'm like, I got to make space for these.
Just need to cram these in there. Yeah, yeah.
But there was one point too where I was like shooting a bunch of guys in a hallway and they like piled up till there was like 8 bodies on top.
Oh my
God. They just kept running in like a ducks on a like
there are some
shooting
cool,
range.
There are some cool Easter eggs in this DLC though. Hanson, did you find the, since you upgraded to level 5 hacking, did you find the terminal behind Quinn's workstation? It's like you push a secret button, it opens up. I didn't have it unlocked and there was no way to get it, so I couldn't. But my first playthrough, like you hack it and you realize that he was the secret voice all along, even though you figure it out later. But it was a nice little thing.
No, really? I missed that.
Cool. Yeah, because once he's like, in his Irish like voice, he's like, I'm getting the hell out of here, and then I left you something, so you can finally get to his little secret back room. But then there's like
and
another
Praxis kid down there.
Yeah. Yeah. And then there's like a secret button and the wall opens
up. Oh, cool.
And
no, I
stash
don't think
with more
I
ammo.
Did that.
I spent a lot of time trying to figure out how to get in there and get that Praxis kid.
Yeah.
Because you could see it for like half the DLC, and I'm like, how do I get in there?
Turns out you just
like,
gotta wait.
Yeah, of course. It's so annoying.
Okay. Let's get to that helicopter crash right
out
of the gate.
I want to talk about that last time.
Okay. Why do you like this
because,
so much? What do you want to talk
because
about?
My first playthrough, like, I thought that, like, normally in a video game, you just would have to watch her die and it would be sad. But in this one, you get a choice. Like, you can decide to try and save her. And it's pretty hard, especially on the highest difficulty, especially on stealth, like, playthrough.
Oh, man.
But I eventually got it because you just got to memorize who to take down first and patterns and stuff.
Is so that it's fun? Like,
I thought it was fun. Yeah, you sneak through on the right. You take out the two guys on the right, and then immediately you throw EMPs to take out the robots. And then you got a stealth. You got a sniper tranquilizer dart the guys with the Gatling guns. And then once they're down, then it's just picking off everybody else.
Okay, just make a system out of it. Yeah, a lot of people wrote in and had a tough time with that. Like Nathan Wesley said, man, that crash fight would have been a real pain if I hadn't saved up 20 candy bars. I still saw the video of Adam Jensen just shooting his, God, take down this Hershey's. Gotta shave Malik.
Yeah, exactly.
Barbara Joe writes in and says, I totally let Malik die. I tried fighting off the goons a few times, but I had been mostly going stealth through the game. I was destroyed pretty quickly every time. Mm. Eventually, I said, screw it, and ran for the elevator as fast as I could. I was treated to a scene where the bad guy had dragged Malik out of the ship and executed her. I regret nothing.
I don't remember the executions. The first time through, I just let her die.
Oh, yeah.
Walked away.
It probably varies with how many people you take out or not. Because otherwise, if you don't do anything with the enemies, then it just blows up and she dies.
Right. I was just like walking away. I'm like, I'll see you later. And then you get like a thing over your radio of her like screaming like,
yeah. Yeah. She goes like, you're on your own now. Give him hell. Yeah.
Is that what happened for you?
Yeah, I just immediately was like, well, goodbye, Malik. I didn't do your little side quest and I have no attachment to you whatsoever.
I just do not care at all.
And then Jensen just like has this super just average monotone line where he just goes, Farida. And like says her name. And then Farida or something.
I thought you said Fajita.
Fajita, yeah.
He's really hungry.
Yeah, all those candy bars are just an appetizer. And then
gut rot. I need some real food.
But then Pritchard calls in and he actually has some real emotions about it. Where he's like, oh my God, what's happened? But it's like, I don't care. She flew a helicopter twice. I have no reason to love her.
It's funny too, because even if you save her, she's like pretty much a non-entity for the rest of the game.
And then the DLC, there's just like her replacement. It's basically like Mass Effect when like you let the Krogan die. It's like, hey, here's another Krogan, everybody. It's that Keitner character or whatever her name was in the DLC. It's like, here's another person who's basically Malik again. All right. But a lot of people had a tough time with that. And then going back to China, saved the little noodle boy in the noodle factory.
Yep.
I could not. It was really frustrating because like I would be in the vents looking at him and he'd be like, oh, dad. And then I'd sneak down and go to the doors and there's like no option for hacking or unlocking this thing. And so I'm just like staring at him and he's like a foot away. And he's like, kid. Please let me be Jensen and scream out to this idiot. But I couldn't, so I had to go back and then realize,
it was like,
of course, hack your way in.
The first time you talk to him, you're done talking to him, he gives you like a hint on where to go. And then he like disappears with camouflage.
It's just the Otacon sequence from Metal Gear, yeah.
Oh, and I'm like, why do you need me to rescue you? Just use that camo to escape.
Because you can't use camo.
Well, you got to open the door.
Yeah, you got to open the door. That's the catch.
I don't know. It looked like he had, I don't know, he could sneak out when another guard's walking through or something, couldn't he?
It's such like a developer shortcut too, just to like not have to deal with some companion AI.
Yeah,
just to have the guy you rescue be like, well, I'm now going to turn invisible and take care of myself, don't worry about
me. That was nice too, because if I'm trying to sneak around and not actually kill anyone, I don't want this guy to hold on.
Right
It's better than that.
Someone actually wrote in, or maybe I just saw it on Google, searching around for trying to figure out how to rescue this idiot. But apparently, he is a big deal in Invisible War. He grows up to...
Oh, interesting.
Yeah,
oh, really?
Yeah, this Tong kid. I had no idea. But speaking of Invisible War, we have John here that writes in from Missouri. He says he wants an augment that lets you change your face, Mission Impossible style.
Okay, that would be cool.
That's great. That'd be a lot of new dialogue. And then he writes in and says, I miss being able to pick everything up, like in Deus Ex Invisible War. Well, it seems like a minor point. Absolutely everything in Invisible War could be picked up and manipulated. Hmm. One of my favorite playthroughs was one where I used the environment as a weapon 100% of the time.
Wow.
You haven't lived until you've knocked someone out with someone else at 100 yards. I haven't found a game since then that allowed everything to be messed with, Elder Scrolls style. Oh, he says, Elder Scrolls style of dragging objects is abysmal. It doesn't hold a candle to Invisible War. I also miss Invisible War's weapon customization, but I'd rather be able to launch things off Pritchard's desk than hit him with a flaming crossbow bolt. Thanks, team. Sorry you didn't enjoy the game. Well, you know, we'll get to that for conclusions, I think, maybe later. But yeah, Invisible War, there's a surprising amount of love out there for a game that was seemed like crapped on. It got a lot of, like eights around there.
I wonder if people... It was a response to, like, well, everybody loves... It's like the Bioshock 2 problem. It's like, everybody loved this first game, so we're going to kind of crap on this one. When, in reality, I mean, Bioshock 2 is a pretty good game. Like, if it wasn't called Bioshock, I think people would have loved it.
Mm. Yeah, definitely. And Invisible War, we should point out, in this lineage, it was directed by Harvey Smith, who went on to do Dishonored and whatnot. Mm-hmm. So, weird interconnection between all these immersive SPF games. All right, should we get to Singapore?
Also, just real quick, did you guys go back to the Hive when we were in Shanghai?
No, I didn't.
I think I did.
No.
China.
Yeah. So there was something I noticed. Sorry. There was like an advertisement that was like, oh, the Hive on Tuesdays is Augmented Ladies Night.
Really? Oh, that's good.
Just like, that's funny. Augmented Ladies, drink free from 7 to 11. It's like, do I have to chop off my arm to like warrant this?
It's totally where they just hide one behind your back. Yeah. Like, oh no. Just like shove your arm inside your sleeves and put like a coat hanger hand coming out. Like, look at this cool augment.
But like also like a lot of augments that people get, like Malik says this. She's like, I've got a couple augments just to help me focus or something like that, like internal.
But you couldn't see them.
Yeah. So how do you prove that? I don't know. Like a scanner?
Oh yeah, I'm augmented.
Just peel back your skin like Terminator. Look at my brain.
But it's like, I don't know.
It's just a little marker.
Just a weird thing.
ID.
Like everyone knows what, like, yeah, ladies night, no brainer, but augmented ladies night? I don't know. Just kind of weird.
You know, sometimes we don't have to get into the whole augmented lives matter situation with Mankind Divine and its marketing, but sometimes I just feel like augments. It's like a fun analogy for things. Just slap it on.
Right.
Isn't this a wacky world?
Even though we talked about it last time, but it totally doesn't make sense because rich people would have augments.
In terms of like little pieces of lore that I really enjoyed, there was a radio that was interesting, talking about like how throughout the world people's resistance to like tuberculosis and AIDS is like going down as a result of all these augmentations, I believe. And so viruses are like spreading around the world again. Yeah,
crazy.
So Deus Ex after Mankind Divided is going to be a post-apocalyptic world. And then it'll rebuild itself back up for the first Deus Ex. I think that's what happens technically. That's not true at all.
I was trying to figure out, like, are you actually talking about something you...
No, I don't know that
BSing,
at all. No. I don't remember the lore of Deus Ex 1 that much. Let's see. We have Matthew Falvey, who wrote in about gameplay a little bit. He says, my favorite part of the game was upgrading to the double takedown. This meant approaching three baddies stealthily, headshotting one, and then charging in for the martial arts takedown of the other two saps. A limited amount of praxis points meant I actually explored the hell out of the game to gain new skills to alter the experience. This game is like Apple. It's great if you play it their way and it's not as freeform as they brag. Thanks for the game clubs. I think that's a good analogy.
Yeah,
play according to their rules and you can have a great time.
Mm-hmm.
But it's going to be a little bit finicky every once in a while and it will constantly want to open up iTunes.
Yeah.
There you go.
I think that's how it works.
Constantly messaging you about your online storage space.
The double takedown is good, especially because it still only takes one energy unit.
Oh,
thing.
Really?
Oh, that is cool.
I didn't get it ever.
Know that.
So, yeah. So, like, first health takedown, if there's two guys talking to each other like idiots, you just come up and then one energy down and keep going.
The animations, I think a lot of them are fun, especially some where it's just like a simple, he's just basically like throwing these rag dolls around everywhere for the takedowns. But it makes me laugh when you do it in a herd and you just like grab one of the guys and then everyone else is just like paused.
Time stands still, yeah.
Right. Even if they have dialogue of like, I think I saw something. Like as you're like 2 feet in front of them, just like ragdolling their friend around the room. And it's fun to like during that animation, try to figure out what's going on in the room. So, like, you're trying to glimpse around with the camera to be like, okay, when the animation camera moved this way, I saw there's a guy down that hallway over there. It's a weird, janky system. But I found myself manipulating it so much to take down entire rooms of just waiting for a guard to walk through the door, press B, take him down, wait for it to recharge, wait for another guy to walk in the door, press B, take him down.
It just, it still throws me off when it's, because it seems like the loudest thing in the world when it's happening. And then you walk around the corner and there's just a guard sitting there like nothing happened. Yeah. Like, well, don't know what that noise was in the other room. A bunch of elephants dancing.
Right.
But, or like, but they'll get alarmed by an automatic door just opening when you open it.
Oh, hey, yeah.
The door opened, but no one came through. I'm going to go check it out.
My favorite is that stealth game trope of, I think I heard something.
Yeah.
How many times in your life have you ever said that or been in that alert phase of like, I think I saw a man over there? It's like, no one's ever like, experienced that.
If they heard like a footstep, like there's all these guards walking around. Oh, I heard a footstep. What is that? It's a different kind of footstep.
Right.
But so many times a guard would like be walking my direction and then I would like hit Q to like take him down stealth. And in the animation, he's facing the opposite way. And I go tap him on the shoulder.
Of course. Like,
not at all what should have happened, but yeah, it was pretty good.
The AI, I think, is probably the worst part of the game, not even including like the dialogue and how often they repeat the same barks over and over and over again, but just dealing with those guys is so sad. And it's not like Metal Gear where they keep calling in reinforcements. Like, you can just clear out a room and then set off alarms and it's like, well, I'm not scared of anything anymore. Yeah. Nothing else is going to come in here. And also, it's like, in so many situations, this was also the case every once in a while in Metal Gear, but it really makes me laugh where the guards will literally be screaming, you can't run now! And then I will just run 100 yards and close an elevator door and like, wow, we give up. especially because they repeat that line so often about like not being able to run. Or it's just like, hey, you crawl an event? All right, you win. You got us this time, Jensen.
Yeah. I mean, the AI is not very sophisticated, but I don't have a problem with it. Like, I don't know. I'll go back and... Like, the AI in GoldenEye is just dumb as rocks, but...
You brought up GoldenEye so many times.
Only because it reminds me of it. But it's like, it's not sophisticated, but it doesn't mean it's not fun. Like, it's a silly game. It's a silly game.
But they're not trying to make it a silly game. Like, GoldenEye, you go back to it, there's paintballs being thrown around, true. And Odd Job running around, you know, crawling through vents. This is like, trying to get serious about Eggman's.
I think a lot of that stuff's more obvious when you're being trying to be stealthy because you're aware of like the guards and how dumb they are and their patrol patterns. When you're just shooting like this round, I just sort of shot everything. And they're still not like great like being super tactical and trying to flank you or anything. But, you know, you don't notice some of those like idiocies.
Yeah, I think so. When you're really studying their movements and everything. What guns did you guys use? We haven't really gotten into that too much.
I stuck to the stun gun and the tranquilizer.
I never had the stun gun.
Just those two.
I don't think I ever went to the shop once in this game.
Really? Well, that's the one I started with. Okay. And that's probably the easiest because when you're sneaking around and people are like getting too close, the guards are getting too close, it's just so easy. All right, they're dead. Mm-hmm. It's so simple. But then the peps, I started using
that. Good.
That gun is amazing in the very last part of the game.
Yep.
When you're in crowd control.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
it made it
for
so
sure.
Easy.
It seems like it was tailor-made for that.
Yeah.
And it's like it's fun to use on one or two guys. But yeah, during the zombie section, which we'll talk about in a bit at the end, it's just amazing.
So for me, just non-lethal. I didn't even carry like the lethal guns in case by accidentally I would shoot someone.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
You were that hardcore? I was mostly using... I had this cool chain gun.
The heavy gun?
Yeah, the heavy, which was awesome for taking down crowds or like bosses and stuff.
Uh-huh.
And then I had
Or women who wouldn't pay their bills.
Revolver.
Oh, did you? How is the revolver? I never picked it up.
It's powerful, which is nice.
Okay.
So it's another one you can use on bosses if you want to take them out in like six shots or something.
Okay.
Oh, right also on. You can get Burke's revolver in his office before the boss fight. Did you get that?
I didn't pick it up.
Oh, that's probably why he had it in the boss fight, because you didn't grab it from his office.
Yeah. Well, no, because he never came out because I killed him in his office.
Oh, okay.
Pretty quickly. I think I just knocked him out and then just shot him right in the head, which is that was my favorite part of the game, is just the freedom to shoot all these guys, which we'll get into in a little bit as well.
Freedom to shoot anybody you want.
It's really a thrill. It's really fun in this type of thing. But I use like the machine pistol I liked a fair amount. Shotgun I thought felt awesome in this game. Like so many times I would just walk down a hallway like the Terminator and just blast these guys away. And then in the end, like the plasma rifle, plasma whatever it is, I use that a fair amount. Really
was that cool?
It. Yeah, for sure.
It looked cool, but I had my staple weapons and like so much ammo that
your
I was
staple
trying
gun?
To carry. And the staple gun was really good. That I didn't have space for it.
But it's tough though because you have to make choices on your inventory because you can't hold all these weapons and their ammo.
That's the thing is you can't hold them all and you feel like you're constantly low on ammo and yet I don't know. It's a weird balancing thing because by the end of the game, I had more ammo than I could possibly ever use. Mm-hmm. So it's just interesting how that game makes you feel like you have to hoard everything and not use it. But at the same time, you end up with more than you really are ever going to need. At least when you're playing, I don't know, just shooting. I feel like I didn't have quite the same problem when I was going stealth.
Yeah.
I don't know why.
No, I never felt low on ammo and stealth, primarily because you have to just sit and wait for people to get close and then take them out that
right.
way.
Right.
Yeah. Tying back into that comment about treating it like an Apple product and like you play the game they want you to play, you'll have a good time. I was thinking about a lot in while trying to play this because I didn't have the best time this round for the third segment.
How much of it was the DLC though? If you'd take that chunk out.
That was a big part of it. Yeah. If I read through my notes during that entire section, I kept writing, I'm miserable. I've died. I think I probably died in this game, no exaggeration, over 200 times.
Wow.
Constantly. And I'm really bad apparently, but I feel like if it's the type of game where if you devote your all to it, there's a lot of great stuff that can happen there. And I was thinking like, man, this is the type of game where like, I'm sure the hardcore fans will turn off that objective marker because you can do that in the menu. And I bet that would be a much more interesting experience. Like if you want to devote the man hours to not knowing exactly where you have to go and just listening to dialogue, like I think there'd be some thrill in that. And then when you get to Singapore, they basically do that. Which I thought was really cool. Right when you get to Singapore, it's like, I don't know what the hell's happening here. It's spooky, no objective marker, and it's a relatively big space, and it's just kind of a, hey, go nuts, explore, find what you need to do.
Yeah. Oh, when you're looking for the scientists, you mean?
You didn't even know that was really your objective. You didn't know where to go. And then I stumbled across the first lady, and I found out later you can find them in any order.
Right.
And then it's like, okay, try and find the other guys. They'll give you some vague clues. Good luck. I really thought it was a cool segment for forcing you to not have a clear objective.
Yeah, the coolest thing ever.
It was like the greatest thing I've ever seen in my life.
That part was interesting because I biffed it really hard when you like set off the distraction and all the guards come running out.
Yeah.
I wasn't sure where I was supposed to go because I didn't realize that the door opens up where the guards come from. So I was standing out in the open as this army of guards is running towards me. And the last second I used my invisibility and they all ran past me. I'm like, I was like, oh my God.
The Arby's behind
yeah.
you.
Yeah. And then there was like a stampede. And I'm like, that's actually pretty cool because like that could have gone horribly wrong.
Yeah.
4 for 5.
Oh, that invisibility is always great.
Yeah.
It's no wonder. Invisible War indeed. That's how I played this game. I really enjoyed that segment. It really cracked me up. There were so many conversations about how are we going to synchronize all these people? Don't worry, I have a plan. And then every scientist you talked to was like, it's impossible. 3 distractions at once? How could we coordinate such an attack? You have cell phones. You've had cell phones for hundreds and hundreds of years. Just send a text and say exactly at this time. It's not hard.
No, but
go
instead,
now.
Instead, he's got this like really, or like a walkie-talkie. He's got this really weird idea of like, you got a GPL implant. I'll make it vibrate.
Yeah, Pritchard, I need you to vibrate the GPLs and exact frequencies.
What? That's how it's a Batman voice now, by the way.
It really is. I'm sorry, that's all I can do. Also,
swear to me, Richard.
Jensen thinks he's so cool. There's one moment when you're talking to a scientist where you're like, oh, Jensen, I thought you died. And he goes, I made the mistake of surviving. Douchey.
Oh, that's pretty good.
Nathan Keeling wrote it again about Jensen's cool personality. Mm-hmm. Says, my favorite moment is helping the helicopter pilot, whatever her name is, uncover her friend's
Fajita.
Murder.
Well, that was from the last portion, though.
Yeah. But he says, when you finally find the killer and blackmail him, he responds saying, killing the bitch was just an accident. To complete the quest, you have to walk away and hack some terminals, which airs his confession on the news. However, if you purposely fail the quest by stabbing the bastard in the chest, Malik yells at you for ruining the plan. Jensen's straight-faced reply is, would you believe me if I said it was an accident? For the no-nonsense Jensen to quip such a perfect one-liner, I had to pause the game because I was laughing so hard. So some people like Jensen's personality.
All right.
He has his moments to shine.
His voice still throws. It just doesn't seem real at all.
Yeah.
It's like, why is
your
voice so
gravelly? Well, the
Solid
Snake's voice seem real.
I like to think that that's also an augment. Like you know
like
what I mean?
Normally just sounds like Tiny Tim.
Well...
Oh, hi guys.
I like to think that before he had his accident and got like replaced with robot parts, so like he was sounded more human. You know what I mean?
But you hear him in the beginning of the game. Nothing he sounds that way.
Yeah.
This is your own Wade lore.
Right. That's
you
my
just
own
mute
Wade.
The game.
That's
the
only way I can make sense of how strange his voice comes across for most of the game.
All right, that's fair. So Barbara Jo wrote in with just a bunch of breakdown moments. She did a great job, and she was on the Uncharted 4 game clip as well.
Oh, cool.
Anyways, she says, hello, Game Informer. Here's some thoughts about the ending of Deus Ex Human Revolution. Number 1, zombies? What the actual F? For a game that was trying to ground itself in some sort of reality, I was really surprised that the end went off the rails like this. I really liked the tension at the beginning of the game with the hacker who had been compelled to kill himself. It showed that the real bad guys could get into people's heads and make them do whatever. That's kind of terrifying. But Hugh Darrow sent out a signal that made everyone act crazy because he wanted to rid the world, wanted the world to abandon his technology. If he wanted that, he would have just made his signal kill every augmented person on the planet. That would have been far more effective than zombies.
That's a good point.
Well,
actually.
Yeah.
Although he just didn't want to. Actually, I'm more confused now after thinking about that, because like, he's instead like, I'm going to make them all insane and kill other people. Yeah, I don't know.
To prove that it's good.
Well, like, okay, this actually ties into the last conversation with him to try and uncover like what his true motives are. Like, how did you guys do with that?
Not well, Wade. I did not convince him of anything. It was just a dead end every conversation.
You didn't get those pheromones, did you?
No, I didn't. I really didn't.
They don't work if you try them. Like, he accuses you of being like a sociopath trying to just control people's emotions.
Oh, it's a neat twist
because it works every other time in the game, but this time the game's like, ah.
Your sorcerer's ways will work on me,
yeah.
Jensen.
Yeah.
I appreciate it. I thought it was an interesting twist a little bit in that final conversation when he was basically like, I'm fighting against the Illuminati, which you in theory are also saying like, hey, the Illuminati could take control of people. Like, this is why augments are a bad idea, even though I have a leg brace on, which is flirting with an augment.
I have contacts augmented.
So how did it go for you then?
Well, so the first time I played through way back, I tried the like augment to try and control the conversation, and he just totally like called me out and was like, this is why da da da. So this time it's a harder conversation to get a handle of, because it's randomized. Like, his the things that he'll say are not always the same.
So
you got to like tailor your responses just based off what he's accusing you of. So basically what it comes down to is you figure out like how, if you do the conversation correctly, you figure out that his body is not as receptive to augmentations as normal people's are. So
it's just spite.
He's like a little bit jealous that he can't like go with the rest of humanity like down this road.
Yeah, I did hear that. And then Jensen's like, he's like, you're just worried that everyone's going to realize you're not the whiz kid, that everyone's going to be smarter than you and you're not going to have this prestige anymore.
Yeah, so that's part of that. And there's one more thing I can't remember, but basically you kind of put the finger on the nerve of like his insecurities and how his intentions aren't quite as pure as he wants them to be. So he has that sadistic side of him. And then eventually, if you do that, he'll give you the code to shut down the computer.
Oh, so you guys shut down a computer.
The
one in the final boss.
Yeah. So he'll give you the code and he'll see the error of his ways.
Oh, right. Cool.
Yeah, that's what happened with me as well. He had a line about Daedalus or something too.
Oh, like, I really want to talk about
too
this.
Too close to the sun.
Yeah, it's kind of like
watching
Daedalus.
Watching my son.
I literally wrote it down because it was my favorite. He says, I'm more like Daedalus instead of Icarus, wherever he was compared to, watching as his child crashes into the sea. And then it like zooms in on him looking out at the ocean. And maybe it looks different on the console versions, but on the PC version, it made me laugh because like it's zooming in on what he's looking at, and it's like three seagulls flying around, except they have like two frames of animation. Just like
the worst looking gulls.
Of all the things, like, don't zoom in on it. It looks like trash.
I know, it's great.
But I love that moment where it's like, oh, Hugh, it's kind of cool seeing him up in this tower and whatnot. And then after really botching that conversation, he just like sits down. He's like, ugh, try and stop it. I was like, all right. And I just took out a gun, like looking around the room, like, is anyone going to mess with me? And just shot him right in the head and he died.
Oh my God.
And no one made a big kasha out of it. No one messaged me. There was no achievement, no prompt. It's just like, if you want it, kill him, right? Knock yourself out. We're not going to acknowledge it in any way, which normally I like it when games acknowledge it, but I love that it's basically kind of sort of the final boss. And it's like, kill him if you want. All right, move on.
Yeah.
It's so cool. What'd you do, Reeves?
It's very similar to Wade's, where I had a long conversation. I got the goal scene and then. I sort of talked him into like, hey, you're being an asshole, like you're being a spoiled child, and he just gave me the codes. I remembered him like killing himself my first time, but I might just be misremembering that.
I think one of the seagulls killed itself.
That's right.
What you're thinking of.
Flew through the window. Into its eye.
But yeah, I mean, what I like is throughout the whole game, he acts as like this pretentious, like I know everything sort of dude.
Mm-hmm.
Even with his, you know, Greek analogy there, the child falling into the sea, he's still kind of like on his preachy high horse there, like, oh, my pride's so wounded, like da da da. But yeah, like eventually, if you can bring him down to the point where he was like, oh my God, like, yeah, I'm just an asshole, like trying to mess with the world.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's kind of cool to see.
The zombie thing, I think it was a real high moment and a real low moment. Like, I think the AI looks stupid. It's a lot of mirrored animations as they like run towards you awkwardly. The idea of like triggering everybody in the world and changing the gameplay up, I think is cool. Mm-hmm. You know, zombie trope.
Yeah.
I don't know if I'm as crazy about it.
It did kind of remind me of a couple of the Uncharted games where it's like, oh, this feels out of left field and kind of like a different genre of game.
It reminded me a lot, and even though it came out after, Metal Gear Rising. Do you remember that part in Denver when all like the guards just go nuts? It's like the Jack's Back sequence.
I never actually played Metal Gear
Rising. What? That would be a fun Game Club game. That game is nuts. Not great, but nuts. Anyways, I like the idea of just twisting up the AI like that. And like you said, the Pep's gun can just mow these guys down.
Definitely.
But it's kind of freaky at times, just having these guys like that in Singapore, like it was completely empty. And then I crawled through this vent and found one guy who was just losing his mind. He's like, I see you in the vent. I see you in the vent. And then he's just in the corner, basically like rocking back and forth. Mm. And like, well, I'll shoot him and move on quietly. and then like in the emails, as people's minds are cracking, in the emails, like a lot of them will end. What does it say? It says like, I can see it, mommy. And just like
weird.
Even they're like losing their minds as they're typing. It's messed up.
Did anybody actually get that chip that's supposed to
I did
mind control?
Because... The first playthrough I did, yeah. And so what happens there is what's her face? Is it Zhao?
Oh, her face.
Yeah. What? No, so before the third boss battle you have with the augmented dude, in that weird like bodies exhibit, she'll trigger your upgraded chip and make you like malfunction if you get the the switched out chip.
I was really curious about that because earlier on they said like you need to go visit the limb thing.
Yeah,
we really recommend it, and
I
didn't do it, and so then it was just this weird sequence where I loved Jensen glitching out and like this is building to something, and it really didn't. She said something like, "I'll take control of you." Oh wait, never mind. Yeah. And I was wondering what would happen.
Oh, I didn't get the upgrade.
Because like, so my first playthrough, when you start glitching out, I'm like, "Oh, I better get this fixed," and got the switch, the
right
chip
into the Illuminati's plans.
Right into.
So then,
hands.
What does he do? If you're under control?
No, you're not under control. You're just not as effective. I think if I remember right, like you lose some of your augments or something during the fight.
Oh, weird. Okay.
That's all it is. Is there a scene where he's like
and
on
like,
the ground?
And I think you're like some of your heads up display stuff is like glitching and stuff. It was a while ago, okay. but that fight's cool because you can hack. I think how you do it with a pacifist playthrough, I guess boss battles don't count, but you hack eventually into this these two mobile turrets, and they just kind of like follow you around and just attack him on site when he appears.
Oh, that's awesome.
But since he's cloaked, you got to like stun him first, so he's just standing there. Otherwise, they won't know where he is.
A lot of people had a tough time with that boss fight too. It wasn't too bad for me.
Yeah, I just shot him a bunch.
Yeah, same here. It was a cool idea. I don't know if what they're going for is, oh, there's bodies everywhere. Which one's him? And it's not like I was ever confused or tricked at any point, but it looked awesome to have moving corpses like that.
That was, super freaky.
It would have been, in the first playthrough, it was confusing. It was like, oh, which one is he? But this time, he didn't even get a chance to like go and pretend. Like I shot him so many times so quickly that he was just dead before he had a time to go into that cycle.
So Barbara Jo writes in with point number two. And says, so what's the deal with the scientist lady Megan and Adam? I never really felt like I completely understood their relationship. Were they an item? Yes, they were. Why was Adam so hell-bent on finding her? The only interaction these two characters had was in the beginning and towards the end. Adam often came across as sort of a creepy stalker because I don't have any context for why he would be broken up over her death. And Jesus, what the F was with Megan's lab bedroom? The rest of the game was pretty generic, and then they went with decorating her space in stark white everything. I half expected her to be maniacally twirling a mustache when I saw that.
Yeah, so they just breeze through it in the beginning of the game where they're supposed to be...
They're ex.
And because like you have a side quest with her mom.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
But yeah, I don't think they set that up well enough. And like in the elevator in the very beginning, she's like, Adam, I have something very important to tell you. Adam, and then Pritchard comes in like he always does.
Yeah.
But I don't think that she returned his affection ultimately.
What was happening? Was there more context at the end that I didn't pick up
on? At the very, very end, like the end cutscene?
So they were using her research and she kept just saying like, this is more complicated than you think. This is more complicated than you think, Jensen. It's not that I'm bad.
Yo, she's totally bad.
She is just 100% bad.
Yeah, she's 100% bad.
Like, but they were just using her research, right?
Okay, but the thing is, like, I mean, maybe they could, like, pull a fast one, but the very last thing you see of the game is a cutscene where the secret villain, Bob Page, which I didn't know this, is, like, the villain in Deus Ex.
In the original.
Yeah.
I assume that's what it was. He's like, call me Bob.
Yeah. Yeah. And with that weird, like, sadistic look on his face.
Oh, is that the post-credit scene?
Yeah. Yeah. And he's also the guy in the very opening of the game, too, talking.
Oh, really?
Do you not get that in some endings?
I've got it in both mine. But anyway, so basically he's talking to someone named Morgan about the wreckage of Panchea. Maybe we can get something from the wreckage. And then he says, I got to go. She's coming. And then he's talking to Megan, and she says, the nanite virus is quite intriguing. I'm looking forward to seeing the hybrid project up close, Mr. Page. And then he says, please call me Bob. So it's like, she knows what's all this, like the nanovirus. That doesn't sound good.
Yeah.
So I think she's just totally 100%. And even like when Jensen rescues her and the scientists, she's like, I got to go. And then she just immediately goes back to this guy.
Well, what is she wanting to do then? Ultimately, I mean, she just wants the power or what?
Like,
what
a girl if, wants. Basically, if she did want to just go back and like to what she was doing before, she would go back to Seraph. I mean, clearly, she'd be like, hey, I was kidnapped, but now I'm back. Protect me. But she's like, nope, back to the captors I go.
But in theory, she's going to be in Mankind Divided then?
Oh, I hope so.
Yeah, I guess she didn't die.
I guess she didn't. Did you guys feel compelled? Were you in sync with Jensen's quest the entire game of like, gotta find Megan? Like,
not
I
really.
Didn't really care.
No.
That was the thing, is like, she's your ex, dude. Like,
yeah, she's clearly been the one. She was the one who broke it off, clearly.
Yeah, he was whipped.
Yeah.
But her room was neat.
Her
pure
room,
white.
I thought her room was neat, and I was trying to figure out, like, what is the metaphor here? Like, what is she? Because the rest of the game is all drenched in yellow, but why that room?
Because she's the black pure, and white? You know, wearing white before Labor Day,
well,
or whatever the
hell. Yeah, but except she wasn't, because, as Wade pointed out.
Well, that's what makes it art. It's a twist.
Yeah.
Never see it come.
It rhymes.
Barbara Jo says,
poetry.
Just in general, and I'm really glad I beat the game. Everyone was very right about the augments. The game gets much more fun when you get more abilities. The story is mostly garbage, but I went with it. I will wait for some reviews to see if the sequel looks like it's worth picking up. Thanks again for joining the game club. Playing through the game and discussing it with the community has been a lot of fun. Can't wait for the next one. Thank you, Barbara Jo. What did you guys think of the ending? Which choice did you have? Which choice did you go with?
To me, I guess the only clear choice for me was like broadcasting everything and being like, hey, this is what Hugh Darrow did. Mm-hmm. He was an evil prick. And... you know, expose everything.
Yeah.
Like, I didn't want to go with what Taggart or Seraph said, or even, like, self-destruct.
Mm-hmm. Okay, hang on
a
second.
I got the impression the self-destruct option was, like, this is the ultimate good one, because then they can make their call.
I just sprinted right towards self-destruct.
Really?
Yep.
Really?
And it killed myself. Right. Also, I did that in, well, I guess I won't spoil other games.
Explosion or something?
It fades to black, and then it's the sound of explosions, and then, like, you know, it's that final cutscene where it's like live action stuff, Metal Gear style, and it's like, oh, the people choose, they can always choose the right path, have faith in people.
Nope.
It's like footage of people voting and giving like a thumbs up and stuff.
Nope.
You didn't have that at
can't,
all?
No, people can't be trusted.
Oh, wait.
What's interesting about that ending is that one is pretty much non-canonical.
Yeah, that's gonna be the hardest one to parse with the next game.
He got better. Matt Sweatman writes in and says, just finished the game and was wondering about the choices we're given at the end. It seems we have three buttons to choose from, each one broadcasting to the public a different version of the truth. I usually choose to play my games as the good guy, so I chose to go with Daryl's message since it was the closest to the truth, even though I felt like it skewed a bit anti-technology. Do we know which ending is canon? Also, the computer AI mentioned an option to blow up the base, killing everyone and covering up the events, but I didn't see any obvious way to trigger this ending. Is there a way to get this ending? Love the game club and anxiously waiting for the next game. Yeah, it was confusing because like they're like, you have two options for me, and we'll get into this in a bit. And then there was like one button in front of me, and I was like, is this a mistake? And then you have to like run in this hallway down this long hallway to the back and the other side of the facility, basically. Mm-hmm. Like, here's the other button for killing everything.
I guess it was really hard to miss that, like that hallway leading to the self-destruct button.
Yeah,
like, I guess
but it
right
is
there.
Weird that it's like another hallway you got to go down.
You think it'd just be the three different buttons.
Right.
So I had two. And they mentioned three. You guys mentioned three options.
Well, there's the one. You didn't have the third?
I didn't have a third.
Okay. There's the one right in front of you, which is like, transmit the message.
I had that one,
exactly as is. And then she's like, or I could use my computer algorithms to rewrite the message and transmit this other message that's a little more positive.
Like, well, I think that depends on if you even talk to Seraph or Taggart, because...
Is that the problem?
I was about to go down the elevator. I'm like, oh, wait, I forgot to talk to those dudes. So I went back and found both of them. But if you don't talk to them, you don't know what their side of the story is or what they want from you. So then you just won't get those options. And when you go down there, you'll have two, essentially, unless you talk to Taggart and Seraph.
Yeah. That was exactly my problem. Okay. I was running towards that elevator, and I saw, like, I could hear Seraph talking and Taggart, like, hey, come talk to us, come talk to us. I'm like, all right, I assume they're down this way. And then kept running, got on the elevator, and it's like, this is the point of no return. I was like, cool. I love that part in games. Got on the elevator, and then it says, like, objectives failed.
Oh,
secondary objectives failed on the top. And I was like, oh, I really wanted to talk to Seraph again, too, because I like the voice acting so much for him. So what is their argument? What do they say?
So Seraph is like, listen, this is going to destroy all of our chances to control our evolution. You know, the same old Seraph thing he's been doing the whole game.
Classic Seraph.
Taggart's like, listen, we didn't want to outlaw augmentations. We just want some regulation, like... Da, 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 da. You should say that it was instead this weird, corrupted supply of I forgot the
like
name of the
terrorist, the anti-freedom humanness, anti-freedom humanists.
Taggart's buddies.
Yeah. So Seraph was like, "Hey, have a pro-aug message," and Taggart was like, "Hey, have a pro-regulation message." And then So it's basically like, "What do you think is right?" But I don't know if any of those really matter in the next game, because people are still going to have all those viewpoints. Like, there's going to be the pro-human side, the anti-human.
It's not Mankind United.
Yeah, that's what they were saying when we did the cover strip, is there's not really a canonical ending. Like, either of those endings kind of fits into their game plan for Mankind Divided, so your ending official can sort of fit. And even Panchia was still sort of destroyed in the official ending, so kind of fits. It's just weird that, like, Jensen survived.
He just swam home.
Yeah, somehow.
It's like the end of Jaws.
Yeah.
So in the Facebook group, Richard Lynch posted, here's the one thing that I'm curious about. Has this game club made any of you more or less excited for Mankind Divided? Honestly, this look back has me a tiny bit nervous. Jeremy Bowl says, I'm super excited now for a game that I thought was going to be garbage. Matt Sweatman, who we just read, says, the game isn't without its flaws, but I'm sucked enough to make this a day one purchase now for the sequel. Chris Kahasa Pina Petalon, Redton, Coquelin. I just hope it starts off a lot quicker from the get-go, because holy damn, I don't remember this game starting so slow. But once I got augmented and whatnot, I ended up really loving the game again. And then they also had a discussion about what they want to see carry over for sure.
Mm.
And I was curious, because I haven't been following Mankind Divided coverage too much. What about like the battery system? Is that staying the same for like dealing blows to people and stuff?
Changing it. I think... Dishonored was kind of inspirational for them in a way. And I think it's more of a meter now, and I think part of it, they were really confused. They didn't have it finished and sorted out when we were on the cover trip, but they did say that it'd be similar to Dishonored in that a portion of it could recharge, and then you'd maybe use different things to recharge it fully, which I like that idea. So you always have a little bit of something to work with.
Lobo something.
Lobo something.
Nice.
To Chris, although I would say, if you start the game again and go New Game Plus, then you'll just have a lot of your unlocks right away, and it makes the game a lot better.
That's true. So, or you could take the Jojuba route and just cheat out of the gate and then quit.
Yeah,
it's also cool.
Not finish the game.
Let's see. Nathan Mack writes in and says, hey guys, love the podcast, especially Game Club. Thank you. It's got me playing games I usually gloss over. Deus Ex was a superb pick. Love the story, but the boss battles, clunky inventory system, and static environments were a bit of a letdown. I'm extremely glad I experienced it. Looking forward to Human Revolution. I think he means Mankind Divided. Mm. For the next game, I'd love to see Dishonored. I didn't have high hopes for it when it first came out, but it really exceeded my expectations. I'd love to play through it again alongside the GI crew. It's an interesting choice. Maybe. Bruce Dixon writes in and says, another yeah for Game Club choosing imperfect games. Two nominations for me, Kaya Dark Lineage and Cameo. The original Cameo. Oof,
interesting.
So, it's interesting. He's like, hey, I kind of like this imperfect game. It's, you don't have to do just a perfect game like Final Fantasy VII and almost Uncharted 4 every single time. Where do you guys stand on good games versus imperfect games for Game Club?
I like shaking it up.
Yeah.
Having imperfect. I'd even go, it'd be fun to do like a straight up bad game. Like what people say, like, this is game is not good.
Let's do Martian Gothic.
Oh, that's a great
not
idea.
Saying, I definitely not want to do that a lot, but maybe a shorter one.
I still really want to do Jurassic Park from Telltale.
See, that's a good example. That one's pretty considered bad.
So some people don't want to do it.
I think this one is a perfect choice because there's a lot of points that people can either like or don't like that we can discuss. And also there's many ways, like there's many, different ways to carry out scenes and like discussion or like your conversations in the game. Like the press conference was a perfect example of like ways to play the game that I had no idea. Mm-hmm. So I think that's a great one for Game Club.
Yeah. Overall, I'm happy. I am endlessly thankful that you picked up the slack weight and jumped
on. Yeah.
Crucial. I'm happy with the choice. I felt like I couldn't give it my all just because it's not really my genre, and I felt kind of gross.
Okay. Sure.
Just like, I feel like a little bit out of my element. It's like I'm speaking a foreign language here. I don't know how nitty gritty I can be, which kind of bummed me out.
Should we get an RPG guy on this, like Joe Juba or somebody?
God, wouldn't that just be ideal? Yeah, but I do like the idea of having the imperfect game, flaws and all and whatnot. So people wrote in, they're like, oh, are you ever going to go back to like 80s or 90s games, stuff like that? Would you ever go back again? I don't know. I have a game in mind for the next one. I'm curious what people think about coinciding upcoming remasters with a game club. I feel like that's a good way to go.
Interesting. Interesting.
But what do you guys think about doing a new game versus old game?
I like old.
Around?
I like.
But it's tough because it's going to be like holiday season, and so many other editors here are going to want to play through the new stuff.
They're all going to want to play through the stuff that's coming out.
Yeah.
As it's coming out.
Right. And so it's tough to be like, hey, take a lot of time to go back.
Almost isn't the time. Either for our editorial staff to go back and do an old game.
But community doesn't care. They shouldn't have to care about our schedules.
I totally get it.
What I like about it, though, is it's like a super replay, but like mixed with book club. So it's like you really get to dive in deep with games that people might have played years and years ago and forgot about. And I don't know. And someone said games that I glossed over and didn't get a chance to play.
So you're pro game club is what you're saying.
I'm pro like older games on game club.
Okay. No, I agree.
I would love to hear feedback. I mean, I can't promise that we're going to go with it, but it's always kind of fun to see what people email in and suggest. So feel free, if you have suggestions for the next game club game, send them into podcast@gameinformer.com. If you have like formatting tips or things you liked about this, didn't like, definitely let us know. We come hell or high water are going to have a consistent cast next time around. I am going to handcuff people to this table to make them stick around.
Where would we get handcuffed?
It's not important. So we'll announce the next choice soon. We might be able to squeeze in a small one before the one I have in mind. So Reeves, maybe one that you're shooting for might be,
that'd be cool.
Maybe we might be able to squeeze it in there.
Squeeze it in, squeeze it out.
That's right. But again, thank you so much for everybody that played along, people that bought this game. We are endlessly thankful for playing along with us and sending in a bunch of emails. We had a bunch of emails that I didn't get a chance to read, so the community is fantastic. Thanks, everybody. I'm happy with this third segment in particular. Not my favorite part of the game, but I feel like we finally got our groove going on a Deus Ex game club.
And
have a consistent cast.
Are you looking forward to the new game? Or you think you're going to actually play it?
No. Really?
I don't know. As I was dragging myself along through this game, I kept thinking about it. And I'm sorry. It was a grind. It was a grind.
It's a good game.
I know. DLC. It's a very cool game. Like, I will totally give it up. I totally understand why people love Human Revolution. I think it's a cool game with a lot of style. It's just, maybe it's just a matter of devoting a lot of time to a game, but something was just a slog for me.
It had some rough edges that I think could be sanded down. Hopefully, Mankind Divide does that.
I'm sure I'll start it, and maybe I'll get completely sucked in. But as I was playing it, I was like, I don't think I'm going to be playing Mankind Divide, but I don't know. We'll talk about it on the podcast, I assume, very soon. I think that is coming right around the corner, so I look forward to talking to whoever's reviewing it about it. But is that it? Anything else you guys want to say about Deus Ex, Human Revolution?
There was one thing that slipped through the cracks.
Yes.
Here's the thing. I hacked every single computer I found
to
read all those dumb emails. But there was one that I kept finding, and it was such a funny Easter egg.
Please.
You know, it was a Nigerian prince email.
Oh, really?
Oh, okay. Really?
Did you guys ever find those?
No.
They're on like almost half the emails.
That's awesome.
But like,
I do remember those.
So urgent response needed. Dear sir, having consulted with my colleagues and based on the information gathered from the Nigerian Chambers of Commerce and Industry, I have the privilege to request for your assistance to transfer the sum of $47 million into your account. The sum, blah, blah, blah. And it just keeps going on. And like, I need your bank information. And
That's good. There's other like replies of people like talking.
No one's replied to it. That would be super funny, though.
It'd be funny if you could email them back from Jensen's account.
Like, I know.
I'm very interested.
Yeah.
My voice is changing constantly.
When I first landed in Pangaea, I took a screen grab of it, but there's all these ships docked at the Arctic station, and one ship says the RMS Titanic.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Oh, really? That's cool.
That's perfect.
Anyway, the writing, I always find super interesting in this game.
Wait, coming in strong at the end here.
Because there's so many things I forgot to mention.
Okay.
And I really am curious to see, like, how the characters are written in this next game, because
I always felt like the characters in Human Revolution are just too informed. Everyone is like, hey, Jensen, what do you think about like the controversy and this and that and the mission you just went on and what this person
said.
Don't
they have to be just for exposition?
It just, no, like random people that'll just pass by in the hallway.
Oh, okay.
Like I got back from the very first mission, my first playthrough, and I killed the guy who had the hostage. Mm-hmm. And the lady is like in the cafeteria was like, you know, I see why you had to kill him, but didn't you want to know who he was really working for? I'm like, what?
It's just a voice for the game developer to be like, oh, there's choice here.
On the side quest for Malik, you meet up with this guy at a limb clinic to find an autopsy report. And this is something he says. Okay.
Little something.
And this,
like
and this is just a random like dude on the street.
Uh-huh.
It pains me to see this once great city, which stood as a bastion for reform and progress against our oppressive communist origins, succumb to the trappings of corporate bureaucracy and petty corruption.
Oh, boy.
I'm like, what is this?
Well, you can't walk down a street in Minneapolis or Game of Thrones without someone talking about that. About that.
Yeah. So, once great bastion. It just took me out a little bit. But anyway, that's all. That's all.
I know we're trying to wrap up.
I know.
Here,
I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
We go back and talk about Detroit again, real quick?
Absolutely. What was with those corridors?
Oh my God! Did you play basketball? Did you guys find the basketball?
All right, that's it for Deus Ex Human Revolution Game Club, and that's it for this episode of the Game Informer Show. So be sure to tune in next time. We'll have a new episode waiting for you. Bye, everybody.
Bye.